Okay, I'd like to call the meeting to order for the Site Plan Review Technical Advisory Committee, April 4th, 2017 meeting. We have a couple items on the agenda under old business that have requested postponement. One of them we don't have to vote on because we voted on it last meeting. The first one is the application of 505 Lafayette Road LLC owner and Lens Doctor applicant for property located at 605 Lafayette Road, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of the existing building and the construction of a proposed two-story office building with a footprint of 7,000 square feet and gross floor area of 14,000 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said properties are shown on Assessor Map 229 as Lot 9 and lies within the Gateway District. I believe they requested to postpone till the next scheduled TAC meeting. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
And the next item, just for information purposes, the application of Seacoast Development Group LLC for property located along Rockingham Avenue. As I said, requested postponement till the next meeting, so we don't actually have to vote on them today. The next item on the agenda is the application of Pauline M. Dowd, owner, and Tuck Realty Corporation applicant for property located at 288 Peverly Hill Road, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of an existing residence and the construction of a proposed planned unit development consisting of two and a half story buildings with 5 units in Building A, with a footprint of 5,200 square feet and gross floor area of 13,230 square feet, 4 units in Building B, with a footprint of 4,160 square feet and gross floor area of 10,504 square feet, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 255 as Lot 8 and lies within the Single Residence B District. This item was postponed at the February 28th, 2017 meeting. It's going to challenge me to do this remotely. No, this program is different. There we go. And the clicker, if you want to advance, should be right next to the computer. No, the black one next to the computer. And you just have to turn it on. The side there. Is it working? Okay. Okay, who's here to speak to this application?
Yes, my name is Joe Coronati. I'm with Jones and Beach Engineers. I have with me the applicant, Mike Garapi, Patrick from our office, and Mike Keene is the architect. He's also in the audience. At the last meeting, there were some technical items brought up on the plans. We've made some changes to those plans and resubmitted them. I'll do a brief overview of those. I know you have a busy agenda. We switched the sewer system from a one single pump station to individual E1 systems for each of the units. They'll have a common force main that they each pump into, which will pump up to Peverly Hill Road. We've added some detail specifications on the hydrant. We added the 25-foot town access easement across the front for some of your future plans for Peverly and pedestrian walkway that you're planning along the road. And most recently, we also had after we submitted the plans, Jim Gove and Mike Cuomo were able to walk the site. I don't think, I got an email back from Jim saying that the line is not moving. The only thing that's going to change is the wetland line, and it's the main wetland is what they were looking at along here, that they are going to call that the edge of the prime wetland for the plan. So we'll label that on any revised plans. So the units are all still 100 feet. We did not move any of the units, and they're more, at least 100 feet, if not more, from that wetland. And we have no impact in the 100-foot buffer. We also have changed a little bit of the drainage there was a request to create additional treatment. So we've changed some of the grading so that the stormwater that flows off the pavement, it exits into a sediment forebay here, goes over a berm, and then we have a kind of a long swale with filter fabric in it for treatment prior to getting to the wetland to extend the time of concentration. And we still have maintained a wooded buffer in here, which is about 50 feet, which is one of the neighbors' concerns here. And there's still some wooded area in the middle of this that'll be able to remain as well. I think that's the extent of our changes.
Okay. Any questions from TAC folks?
A couple things. Joe, yes. The city's going to require as-builts and will always require as-builts, so if you work in the city of Portsmouth, you should put things on state plane for the design, because now you're going to have to convert the whole drawing over. When you do the as-builts, they'll be required to be on NGVD 88 and on state plane coordinates anyway.
All right.
So you're not saving anything by not doing that. Just for the future. And the finished floors that you're showing for these units, this site was a borrow site at one time. Is that what's going on? I'm just a little concerned that your finished floors are lower than the existing ground, 3/4 of the way around the site, and curious what would happen if it was winter conditions and the ground was frozen, and where would the water go other than in the units? I mean, it would fill up that wetland, and I know that's a big void, but seeing things like this happen before, back about 10 years ago, when we had really high groundwater.
Yeah, we have that hole is quite deep. So the bottom of it is in the 175 range, and the finished floor is at 185. So it would be almost 10 feet deep before we'd get up into the
finished
floor.
Just thinking maybe you should just put a little higher. And the other thing that I guess Ray can speak to it, but right now you're combining the off-site flow coming out toward the backyards with the drainage that you're trying to clean from the pavement. And Ray made a good point that you really should be just like swaling the water away so that the water from off-site is not going into your detention area.
Right, well, we have...
That the flow is not combined.
Yeah, we have a large... I mean, the detention pond doesn't over... We have so much capacity in that area that it's not a concern of ours to have that water introduced into that area. We could raise... The building's up, obviously it raises the pavement up, which raises the, gets us closer to impacting that little isolated wetland.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been sort of there's still a lot of fill going in under the pavement. But we could look at raising it, at least getting up to 186 for the slabs.
Yeah.
186.5.
I think it's worth looking at. I mean, even if the garage finished floor doesn't change, maybe the unit finished floor can go up.
Yep. So the back of it's higher.
Yep. The detail for the sewer manhole that's out in Pebble Hill Road does not show a force main. It shows a gravity line coming into the line, and that's should be called out. I don't know if you do or not, but that's an AC sewer line, so I need special set of general conditions when you're working out there because of the asbestos.
So the existing sewer line's AC.
Yep.
And the
so the detail for the sewer manhole should show all these things, what to do with the asbestos once it comes out of the ground, so you can introduce the sewer manhole and how to tie a sewer manhole in properly. Detail, typical pavement repair detail on D1, match the road thickness of the existing asphalt. And your sewer force main detail is showing a 3-inch force main. I think you're doing a 2-inch, but I'm not sure.
Kind of went back and forth.
Please just check that. Make sure that in the notes for the hydrant, we want a pumper connection, not a stork connection. And somewhere on the detail, it should say that the hydrant opens right.
I should have said this at the beginning before we, but we were all still gathering. We have a really tight agenda today, and I know you all know that. So I'm going to just acknowledge to the applicants right now that if we are coming up with a lot of things that you need to correct, it's very likely we're going to recommend postponing today. We are not going to have a lot of wiggle room on working through things today, and the planning board has requested that they not received halfway complete applications with a lot of things left to do. So I'm just acknowledging we have a really heavy agenda. Everyone on the TAC is aware of that, and we want to allow plenty of time for the public to also have input today. So TAC is going to be very focused on their comments, and if there is a lot of things that still need to be addressed, we're going to likely recommend postponing to the next meeting. So maybe TAC could just think about that in their comments, that these are things they need, you know, these are minor things or whether things they really need to address before the next time they come back to us. Those are helpful, Dave. Any other comments? Yeah, Carl.
Joe, can you confirm that the turn area was constructed using templates for our vehicles?
Yes, we used a, we have a truck turning plan at the end of the set. And you can't really read it up there, but the truck is almost 49 feet long that we used for the... for the ladder truck. And then we have the turning movement shown on the plan. The last page in the set, T1.
The only concern I would have with that is someone's going to need to get with the folks doing the snow removal, because a third of that truck is overhanging the paved surface, and if they plow right up to the edge of the paved surface, we're not going to be able to turn around in there. So that'll need to be need to be taken care of.
Do you have a plan for snow removal? I didn't see anything on the plans.
Typically, it's just edge of pavement, and we have a note that says if those areas fill up, it can be hauled off site.
Do you remember where that note is?
So I'll have to look for it here. It's typically on our site plan. Okay. Not, we can add it. It's one of our standard notes.
Okay. Carl, did you get everything covered?
Almost set. Yep.
Peter.
Yeah. Joe, I'll let you finish writing.
Yeah.
I did get the letter from just now from Rockingham County Conservation District confirming the delineation, so thank you for that.
All right, great.
But I did have a question. Your plan, it's hard to tell, but your plan shows the buffer on the site plan not touching the units, but then you look at the next plan, the grading and drainage, and you have drainage around the units, and it looks like there's a drip edge going around the units that's probably in the buffer, and I don't know how you're going to build that without disturbing the buffer somewhat. And that is going to be in the buffer a little bit, maybe, but I guess I need that to be clarified. Maybe show the buffer on the grading and drainage plan, too.
Yes, we can do that.
So on the landscape plan, it calls out the landscaping, which I have to say there's very little landscaping, but it calls out the ones that are listed in your table, but it doesn't, there's really not much landscaping. So I was wondering about that. And then it doesn't call out the ones at the straight ahead at the very end. There's some, looks like some new shrubs that aren't listed. They're probably one of the two types, but that's not listed. I'd like to see more landscaping throughout there, if you can get it in there next to the parking area, or if the site's really wooded and you're retaining the stuff that's there, then show that, but that doesn't show up at all.
Mm-hmm. All right.
To see what's there, so that'd be good to show.
Yeah, we can add the proposed tree line, because there's a lot of,
great.
The site is almost entirely wooded.
I'm just gonna jump on that and say that this needs to be a full plan, not a
plan that's up in the corner of another plan, and it needs, and the lighting and landscaping need to be separate. It's too many, too much information.
I was gonna say the same thing. The lighting and landscape, it'd be good to separate them, because it's hard to pull out lights from landscape. They look kind of similar, actually. And then there's no, I don't know how these buildings are being constructed, but we have a requirement in site plan 2.5.3.1A that you talk about the green conformance of the buildings, how the buildings are gonna be built, and what, whether they're gonna be LEED, or what kind of green features they're gonna have, and how that's all gonna work. So I'd like to see something about that on there.
All right.
Oh, and the swale, you call out the North American Green Erosion Control Fabric. Is that going to be planted on top of, or is that underneath a loam and seed, or what's the story on that?
It's usually above loam, and it's got it biodegrades over time, and it has seed already in with it.
So that's like a how you're seeding the swale, basically?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. It allows it to the seed to take hold, so there's no erosion while it's everything's getting their roots, and then eventually it'll biodegrade and it'll be all grown in.
Okay. I haven't seen that before. I think that's it.
Do you need anything more on the wetlands at this point?
I guess it depends. I mean,
if
Dave's comment that you raise a building up requires grading, then you would need a conditional use. So I guess you'd have to address that depending on how you change the plans.
Right.
But right now, if you can make it work and stay out of the buffer and show the buffer line out, then you're fine. But if you can, you might have to move the whole site to do that, because that drip edge is, you know, and whatever you're going to do to put the drip edge in and build those units is going to have some disturbance, I would imagine.
Right. I might even be able to shift that one unit forward.
Yep. Yeah. And you'll probably have a better surveyed line after their field visit.
Yep.
I did have one thing. I didn't understand a comment. It said that in the drainage report, it said that subject parcel consists of woodlands with minimal open space. Am I reading that wrong, or is that just a typo?
I think by that mean by open space is areas that are lawn or not woodlands, because the only area that's not wooded is just the area right around the existing house. Everything else is full woods, mature woods, or.
Oh, okay.
I think that's what they mean by the open space.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Nate, do you have anything?
I'm good.
Okay. Robert? Okay. Ray?
I just have a couple of comments. Roadway runoff, it doesn't seem like all the runoff should be treated, sedimentation, prior to entering the wetlands. It seems like some of it's going cross-country and not going into this treatment swale.
I think it all does. We have,
and then I have a little concern about the grading around the treatment swale, or the offsite runoff from Pebble Hill Road comes towards it, but there's no really opportunity not to go in that swale. Right now, it goes along the base of that. It goes right where the treatment swale is. The offsite runoff.
Right, comes down the driveway.
There's no separation of offsite and treatment. And surface runoff for the impervious surfaces. It's all combining in those swales. There's no opportunity. There's no grading or swales to direct it, to separate it.
Sure, I can follow. But there's any water
along the
down
base
the
of the on the southern part of the site, where there's a steep slope going down towards the treatment swales.
Yes.
Okay. Well. From Pebble Hill Road, that runoff that comes towards those treatment swales should bypass those treatment swales. They don't need to be treated. It's overland flow. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have any opportunity to get by that swale. It's going to enter the swale.
We don't mind treating it again if it.
Well, I don't know if it wasn't sized for that or designed for that. I mean, it doesn't need to be treated.
Right, but it all ends but, up here. And so we curb this drive, so the water comes down the gutter line,
yep,
down the riprap spillway, goes through this section of, which is existing woods, and then enters the treatment swale, and then enters the low point here. then the off-site water from this side comes through a culvert, goes through this wooded area and into the treatment. Everything basically ends up in this area. You're saying you'd like to see somehow that this water goes around the treatment swale?
Well, even the other stuff from the existing house on Pebble Hill Road, all their site is coming down towards that also.
Right, and we have to, their site drains into our site, so we can't alter the grades by raising them or berming them or anything, or else we'd...
You could...
But that's all lawn and woods, not woods, but single trees. It's a nice landscape.
Divert it around the treatment swale is what I'm saying, that's all.
Okay, I think Ray has asked, and maybe you could follow up.
So if you can look at that, I don't know if the design calcs actually accommodated that flow. And I had a question on the water main service coming in. It should be constructed per the city enforcement requirements. The material and specs for that. And it should be, if you want to just add a note to that effect. I didn't see the note for that.
All right.
And then you had a note about a water service fire protection for Unit 9. And I didn't see any fire protection service going to Unit 9.
Yeah, we have our fire lines we have going to units 5 and 6. Right in between the two buildings, we have a 6-inch fire line.
So every unit's going to be fire protection?
They'll have one line going to each block of buildings.
Okay.
And then, and then each will have a separate domestic shutoff.
Okay.
In front, in the driveway.
All set, Ray, or do you
have
one?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Eric?
All set.
I just had a few comments. I had a question actually about a tree clearing permit that they mentioned on the demolition plan. Is that something that we typically
forestry issue? Permit. That's out of the assessor's office.
Okay. Do we typically want them to take care of that before site plan review, or is that something that's separate?
I would say before they, it's separate. Okay. It's separate, but they have to do it.
Okay. I think you have some opportunity to make your plans clearer, and if it's not in the right projection, I think they need to take care of that before next time and put it in the state plan. I mean, that's clearly in our site plan regs. So, so I just had some questions about making sure your legend is clear. You don't have anything about what the open space, you show it, but you don't say what it is. So add that to your legend or figure out a way to delineate that. What is the existing condition of the open space area? Is it currently wooded and you're going to be moving trees in that area?
The open space area is almost entirely wooded. Some of there's an area where the existing house is that's going into open space, and that area has lawn around it.
So you're proposing to remove and make it, and it would primarily be lawn, but most of the open space would be lawn?
Most of the open space will... The open space is the whole parcel, basically, other than the area we're building in.
No, I know,
in, so
but the
be...
part that counts towards your open space calcs, not the wetland area.
Oh, correct.
We require you to say what that open space is going to, what's going to happen to it. I mean, I think you just need to have some work to do on your landscaping plan, too. But
yeah, it's going to be allowed to grow back and go back to nature, basically.
I think you just need to describe that. Your proposed condo sign will require a sign permit. Typically, we like to note that on the plan. I think your access easement was hard for me to see on sheet C4. I couldn't tell where it is, and I don't know if you have any more details on that anywhere, but you could better delineate that so it's easy to distinguish from the surrounding area. And please add parking requirements to your site, your zoning calculations.
Sorry, what was that? Please add what?
Parking requirements.
All right. I think... Yep.
And all of our site plans require that you have a note related to the conditions being remaining in perpetuity. It's section 2.5.42E. You could look at that. I just had a question about the landscaping and the water line service areas on sheet C6. I couldn't tell if there's conflicts between where the water lines are going in and where the trees are proposed to be. So, you know, I'm not asking DPW to answer that now, but I think just could you take a look at that and make sure there's no conflicts with, like, root systems and stuff like that? It's hard to tell.
Yes. I think our water line's outside of all of our islands.
I couldn't tell what the, it was hard, there was no legend on C6, so I didn't know what the little fans are at the end. It might be intuitive to somebody who's used to looking at utility plans, but we're reading these plans thinking about the planning board, and some of them have technical knowledge and some of them don't, and it needs to be very clear to them what they're seeing on the plans.
All right.
Again, I would suggest you should have full plans, not half plans. For example, P1 should probably be a full plan versus part of a plan. Peter mentioned the landscaping plan, and I didn't see anything about the maintenance, which is section 610 in our ordinance. There's a required note related to maintenance. And that's all I have. Any other comments? Can you, oh, in the dumpster. So all of your units are going to be coming out and using a dumpster versus having individual trash cans?
That's what we're proposing, yes.
Okay, so you'll have a weekly service come in and load it out?
Yeah.
Do you have any concerns about that? Okay. All right, with that, do you have any questions for us?
I don't think so.
Okay. So we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. If anyone is here to speak to, for, or against this application, please come forward and state your name and address.
My name is Tom Keller, 297 Pearly Hill Road. I'm here on behalf of my wife, Marie Keller, who's the owner of the property, and she's lived at 297 Pearly Hill Road for 20 years. And she couldn't be here today, so yet she asked me to relate her concerns. Saying on the entire 1/2 mile stretch of on both sides of Pearly Hill Road from the YMCA north to Route 33, that's a full 1 mile counting both sides. There currently exist 29 structures, only 7 of which are 2.5 to 3 stories each, and each on its own separate lot. The remainder being single-story structures. The 9 2.5-story units proposed for the single lot at 288 Pearly Hill Road is completely out of proportion and out of character with the rest of the existing neighborhood. And also the hazardous potential for traffic entering and exiting to and from the proposed development, to and from Pearly Hill Road, as such a precarious location, is a recipe for disaster. I believe these will negatively impact the quality of life and property values of this neighborhood. However, should this planned unit development be approved, I would like assurances, preferably in writing, that my chain link fence, which has been in place for 23 years, not be touched without my permission. And as a direct physical and line of sight abutter, that I am shielded as much as judiciously practicable from the travelway and parking lot lighting, and buffered from the sights and sounds associated with the parking lot, proposed parking lot, and the dumpster areas. And that's respectfully Marie Kelleher.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak to, for, or against this application? Okay, if you're here, you can come up and stand in a line behind the mic too, so you don't have to spend a lot of time walking up from the back.
My name is Bruce Sandmar. I live at 248 Pearly Hill Road. I have to concur with the gentleman, the letter he just wrote about the conditions in that neighborhood, because the whole ways from Route 33 over to at least Banfield Road, there's, besides single family homes, there's only like, there's the YMCA and there's a karate shop. But other than that, they're all single family homes. And I think this is totally out of line with that community and putting in this type of development. The second point I'd also like to make, and he also made the point, was the travel conditions on this road. Beverly Hill Road is a major cutoff between 95 and Lafayette Road. There's a lot of tractor-trailer traffic, bus traffic, car traffic, at almost any time from 6 o'clock in the morning until 6 or 7 at evening. And if anybody's driven this road, you know coming across, if you're going eastbound from 33 over to Lafayette, you're coming across where the church is there. There's no way that people can really see that intersection where this road is coming out. And I know the traffic limit there says 25 miles per hour, but nobody ever goes 25 miles per hour. It's more like 45 miles per hour and higher. And the police, obviously, they're there all the time trying to slow down people. They're doing the best they can, but it's still not enough. People still fly through there. And I don't know, I think there was a line of sight drawing on this indicating maybe that there was enough clearance and enough sight, but there isn't when you come across eastbound on that road. People are going to come out there and they're going to get T-boned when they're trying to make the turn. I live on the other side and I'm like right at the crest, and I can about see both ways, but it's very tough for me when I'm coming back and trying to turn into my driveway. I have to wait and make sure there's no line of traffic coming and then really speed up to get across the highway. These people are not, it's even a worse condition than that. They're not going to be able to see those people at all coming across the top of the hill. So that's just my comments, and I appreciate you listening to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Hi, Tom Reese, 305 Beverly Hill Road. We own the farm right adjacent to the property. Same conditions that we have there. There's a it's a very rural area right now. I look out the back window, it's pitch dark. We're going to have a serious lighting issue there from this. Runoff is a major concern. It's basically a pit in which you're going to be asphalting over a large area of it, and then you're going to ask that to drain down into the natural barriers that exist there. Traffic is a nightmare on the road. That's been well explained. It's quite possibly the worst driveway to pull out of in the entire city. You know, Peter, from your perspective, loss of habitat, that type of stuff, there's some pretty cool animals going on in the back there right now that we've had a really good opportunity to watch. They're nesting there. And the loss of neighborhood there, you've got four people that have their backyards that actually abut that property that will completely change the dynamics of where that is. So this is basically going into a gravel pit that's been graveled out. Limited access on the front there, and you're putting a whole neighborhood kind of in a pit. So those are my concerns.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to speak to, for, or against this application? Okay, seeing no one rise, I'll end the public hearing. I think that there's some work to be done on this project, so I'd entertain a motion from someone.
So I'm going to postpone to next month so they have time to complete the plans.
Okay.
Second that.
So we included a bunch of comments today, and we record all our meetings, so you can always go on YouTube and verify what was said. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, any opposed? Okay. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the application of Deer Street Associates owner for property located at 165 Deer Street. Actually, hold on one second. Do you guys want to do these together or separately?
We can do them together.
Okay.
Lot 3 than lot 6.
What do people feel? Should we do them separately? Probably makes more sense.
It'd be easier to do them separate.
Okay, we'll do them separately.
Comments
okay.
Separate.
So, item D, the application of Deer Street Associates owner for property located at 165 Deer Street, Lot 3, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of an existing building and the construction of a 5-story mixed-use building, including a residential units, hotel, restaurant, retail sales, and a first-floor parking garage with a footprint of 22,073 square feet and gross floor area of 99,307 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 125 as Lot 17 and lies within
the CD5 district, and the downtown overlay district. This application was postponed at the February 28th, 2017 TAC meeting.
My name is Joseph Kiefner with Geo Insight, civil engineer for the applicant. I'm here with Tracy Kozak, the architect, and Bob White, the landscape architect. I guess I was just going to go over what we revised in response to the work session comments and other changes in the plans. One of the main things that we changed starting on the site plan sheet C3.0 is the location of the dumpsters. We are going to include those in the, have those included in the garage until building 4 is completed. Then they will be moved under the structure in building 4. That's the time range is about approximately 1 year. We added some signs, wayfinding signs, entrance-only signs at the entrance between existing bank and proposed lot 5 right there. There will be a dynamic sign that's connected to the garage, the hotel garage, that will tell bypassers on Deer Street to let them know the garage is full and to seek parking elsewhere, if their intent is to park in the garage. It'll be some approximately in that location. Included some exit-only signs at the exit, out the drive. There was a comment, work session about in the full build out, there is a loading zone right here, and there was a comment about a truck being able to pull too close to the building, blocking some egress doors. We added some bollards in those locations to prevent a truck from blocking those doors and the access way. We have updated shown electric meter locations and gas meter locations on the plans. One thing that is still being coordinated with the roadway city's roadway design is the curb ramp across Foundry Place, commonly called Deer Street Extension, before it was named. There's some grade issues that have to be worked out with the finished floor elevation and the proposed roadway grades. There was a transformer shown near the VFW across Deer Street. That is shown for reference only. That is not going to be there. That was just shown for reference only. Show that the electrical issues will be addressed since the project will take down some power poles that are feeding the VFW. Moving on. The full build out, nothing's changed on that. Layout materials, nothing's drastically changed.
community space is still the same.
So it would be helpful, because we've seen this in a work session, but okay. There are not a lot of members of the public at the work session. So okay. It would be helpful to give some context to what you're showing.
Okay.
We don't need a lot of detail on every single sheet, but just some overview.
Okay. I guess I'll go out to the...
And it, just one comment is, you know, the site plan doesn't say what this building is. Should say that on the building, what the uses of the building are, and delineate, you know, within that building what the.
No. Okay.
Okay. So maybe you could describe that. I don't know if you have it. The use of the building.
Building three will be a multi-use. It'll be hotel, retail, and restaurant.
Thank you.
And there will be a first floor parking garage. For the hotel use. We are proposing brick sidewalks with a landscape stripping between the curbing and the sidewalk. Sidewalk width is proposed to be around 8 feet. We will change the traffic direction, which is currently two-way next to Eastern Bank, to one-way entry, and then exit only near the bank. I mean, near the hotel. There'll be a three-car passenger drop-off pickup zone. Some of this parking will be valet parking. Here is a slide of a projected proposed full build-out, along with the proposed city garage. These two buildings are under design and under HDC review currently. This is just a layout materials plan showing transformer locations in the back. One thing, we will need a variance to be within 15 feet of a railroad right-of-way. So that will be going to the BOA for that approval.
Okay, so just so you're aware, TAC can't approve this without the variance being granted. So I don't believe you've actually applied for that variance yet, correct? Okay. You did? I thought it was for the other property. I thought it was lot four. Okay. So I'm just going to propose something here. I'd like to maybe hear from TAC, who've had some time to go through just some preliminary comments. My impression is that you guys are kind of not really there yet so far. I mean, there's a variance pending. We have a packed agenda today. I'd like you to maybe highlight some of the things you really want to tell us today, but this plan is clearly not ready to be moved on to planning board, and particularly with the variance pending. So if you want to highlight some of the things you want to share today with us, maybe get some clarification, that would be a good way maybe to use this time. I'd like to hear primary concerns from TAC at this point, but it's clear to me that you still have a lot of work to do.
Okay.
So maybe you could just let us know, members of your team and so forth, what you really want to communicate to us today.
Okay.
Okay.
I guess one thing that I would like to communicate is the proposed utility sewer specifically layout.
Okay. Sorry, is that not working? There we go.
Yo, try F11. Yeah. I'd like to give you a full screen.
It's better than before.
What?
Screen.
It's a screen.
I can't see it, ever.
You can't, I know.
Ever.
Oh, okay. Never mind.
What do you, which plan are you trying to pull up? Oh, there you go, C5. Okay, you're good.
We added, moved some of the grease interceptors around to the access drive. Now, there were some comments about adding a grease trap for the proposed retail space. So we added that. We have a larger grease trap for the 250-seat proposed cafe area. A grease trap for the second floor kitchen that will serve the hotel. And a grease trap on off Foundry Place that will, I believe that's the right location, for the fifth floor restaurant bar. We also separated the first floor sewer from the upper floor's general sewer location.
Anything else?
I guess I'll go back. The grading and drainage plan. Previously, we were directed to put no flow back on the railroad, that was the supposed agreement, but that has been since been revised. So we're putting existing railroad flow back onto the railroad and existing flow going to the Deer Street, Bridge Street drainage system, piping that to the Deer Street drainage system. We're keeping flows at existing or below. There is a decrease in impervious area on the site. So overall, the flows are less than existing. We have the most of the roof drainage is coming off the roof into the new road. Some of the roof is being piped into an area in the back of the building, rear of the building, and allow it to just kind of some infiltration, very small amount, but some infiltration, then it'll just smoothly flow onto the railroad like it is existing. A small area into the garage entrance that'll be caught in a catch basin that will remove 80%+ of the TSS, and then we would like to connect to the existing drainage pipe that goes out to the west.
Okay. All right, anything else that you absolutely need to communicate to us today? We all have reviewed the plan, so probably have some questions
That's
for you. Okay, so we're gonna move on. Are there other members of your team that you wanted to present today?
Good afternoon, Tracy Kozak, GSA. Just real quickly, a couple of architectural updates in response to your previous comments. We have reviewed the various utility room exit doors, mechanical, water, sprinkler, and electrical. We are showing on the roof plan the mechanical shaft for the kitchen hood. We show the gas regulator meter on the exterior of the building along Foundry Place and on the sidewall, not fronting the street. And also, I just want to point out that we did add some extra car lifts on the back where these were single level spaces. We'd like to provide the double stacked car lifts along the back for an extra 15 spaces in accordance with their narrowing in on an exact tenant for the building. And so we've changed from 114 hotel rooms to 126 at the same time increasing the parking. So there's still a net surplus of 14 parking spaces.
Okay, so that's something you just want to confirm with zoning. Make sure you're not exceeding the amount you're supposed to provide by 120 or 150. I can't remember what the maximum is. We do have maximums. Also, lifts don't count as you know, they're not dimensioned to parking space. They don't meet our dimensional requirements, so they'd actually wouldn't count as parking spaces unless you got a variance.
Okay.
So just keep that in mind.
Thank you.
Bob White, landscape architect. Just to give you an update on some of the issues that we've been working on, which are basically the design intent all along, coming from the vision plan for this area, was to have tree-lined streets. And so we've been designing the streets to have the landscape border the full depth of the building to the curb at 14 and a half feet, a portion of that being devoted to the brick sidewalks and the rest being to planter strips. So we're continuing to work on that. For the section of the project on basically from Deer Street down to the entrance of the garage, we've had some challenges and a lot of coordination with the garage project and Eversource about the location of the duct bank. So where we presently are is that duct bank has been shifted to be under the sidewalk, but we have an issue at this point that a portion of the sidewalk is not on the in the public right-of-way. So we're trying to work out the exact placement, constructability of that duct bank so that it can be within the public right-of-way. So we're trying to fit a lot of things in here. So that's, but still have room between the sidewalk and the curb for street trees and plantings. Another area of consideration that just, again, an update is that in our previous plans, we knew that we were low on light levels in terms of the photometrics. So we have added additional building-mounted lighting to bring up the light levels to be more consistent along the sidewalks. We're not done with that yet, but we feel like it's smoother, and basically we're augmenting that the conventional streetlights in and around downtown aren't a cutoff luminaire, and they basically, you know, and we don't have photometric performance for them. So we're basically trying to accomplish that level of lighting that would be safe for the sidewalks, basically with building-mounted lights. We have explored some other possible substitution fixtures, but it seems like it's going to be a bit of a difficult path to go through a decision process on that. Mm-hmm. We don't know exactly how to approach that with you. So we've heard that the city is quite committed to the fixtures that are out there. So we don't want to cause a disruption in that. But there are fixtures that would comply with the city's standards that would look really nice and be energy efficient and all that, but they're going to be different than what you see in downtown. So we've had great assistance with staff, you know, in small group meetings. So we're just going to continue to do that to see if there's anything more in lighting we want to do. Okay. And then the last sort of open-ended thing that I had posed to you back a while ago was that it has been our desire for at least the 8-foot section of the sidewalk crossings of driveways is to be able to detail that so that the brick sidewalks were continuous. We looked at the plans for Harbor Corp. Mm-hmm. And saw how that was done. We've consulted the company that's provided some millions of bricks to downtown for all the other brick sidewalks. They've given us a variety of technical recommendations to basically increase the depth of the base and increase the depth of the bricks in that. So we're putting together materials that you'll see next time about that. We've also inquired on the availability of bricks that might have a little bit more grit in their texture. It's a little hard with a wire cut brick. They just tend to smooth out. But we are working on all those. All of those are in progress here. I guess the other thing I would note is that we've, as of I think it was last week, there's been a regrading of the road for Deer Street Extension. So everybody's been running to try to keep up with some of the technical issues around the grading. As Joseph mentioned, the corner right here, and this is relevant to building, the entrance to building three, is the street is at one elevation and the floor of the building is 3 feet higher. So doing the math on that to make that an ADA accessible curb ramp and bringing it in the door of the building is we're working pretty hard to make that work. So you will see additional detail on that. We'll probably go through that with some point people on staff to try to troubleshoot that.
it's not an easy challenge, but we're trying to get it integrated with the streetscape design. So that's an update on landscaping.
Okay, thank you. All right, any questions from TAC members at this point, or maybe general comments about improvements without getting bogged down in details, because I think
I have one.
Very much general. A work in progress. Yeah, so, go ahead.
I don't remember if we spoke about this in the work group meeting, but it's an enclosed garage, correct?
No, it's open.
You have to give me the percentage of openings to determine whether or not you can leave it on without mechanical ventilation. It looks like it's more than 50% enclosed. So if you are, if you don't meet the requirement, you have to use mechanical ventilation. And if you do that, you have to have backup power with the generator. So you'd have to show the generator location.
Okay, Carl, do you have a comment?
I need to add another note either under the general utilities or the site plans for radio strength testing, and the verbiage is in the city's site review regulations.
Strength testing for?
Radio strength testing for public safety radio, police and fire.
Okay.
Nick?
A couple of very small, maybe small points. On the parking, it looks like a couple of the spaces would be challenging to get out of once you got in. So you should probably take a look at that. And I'm back to Juliet's comment. I don't know how you left it, Juliet, but the whether a variance is needed for the tandem
it is.
Lift parking.
If it doesn't count, yeah, I mean, it is. Even if it doesn't count toward
right.
the total, it's still
since you're going for the railroad anyway. I think it's a great idea. You've got the lifts in there. I think it's brilliant. And maybe some of the circulation issues get resolved because it would be restricted to valet parking, which would be one way to resolve it. Just small point on the community space. I know you have an excess, so I think it's a small point. I don't think any of the landscaping along the front of the building qualifies as community space. It really doesn't fit into one of the eight categories. A wide pedestrian sidewalk isn't a raised planter. So I think given you don't even need it anyway because of the excess you apparently have on lot two, I'd prefer you not include the raised landscaped areas in the community space from the zoning. And the last comment I wanted to raise, and it's more for the guys on the other end of the dais here, is the grading along the street to the sidewalk. A whole host of issues that I can see between maintenance of hundreds and hundreds of plants in our right-of-way to going up at a 50% slope to 2.5 feet to get to the sidewalk. I would just throw out there, I see why you're doing it in order to chase the grade, but the maintenance looks pretty significant for the city, given what I've heard about even cul-de-sac islands in the middle of nowhere being troublesome. This is a big job to look after this area with the shrubs and perennials. Whether it wouldn't make more sense to do what we did down on Daniel Street with some granite steps and more brick, and then protect the trees with grates rather than raised planters, just to have it look more like downtown Portsmouth. That's all I have.
Peter, did you have comments?
Yeah, I guess in that same area, in that front landscape area, down where it comes into the city's parking garage, it may or may not work, but it doesn't seem like if you come out of the parking garage where the cars go in, there's a little sidewalk on the city's that would tie into the sidewalk here.
Right.
But it looks like it lines up with that planting area Nick was just referring to, rather than the sidewalk. So I don't know how you're going to make that transition, but that's something to keep in mind. I like the tree-lined street. Maybe there's a way to do it with tree grates if you do away with that landscape next to the street. And then on the landscape planning schedule, it lists what the symbol is for trees and shrubs and ornamentals, but not the specific landscape species.
Yeah, we haven't specified plant by plant.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
We're just not there yet.
All right, great.
Yeah.
Julian, can I just add one thing on what Peter said, because he jumped over to lot two. Right? Lot two is the community space between the buildings.
Oh, right. I was on lot two.
Since that's being discussed, I just have one small point. Sorry,
I'd like to keep our comments to lot three.
Well, okay.
All right.
For brevity.
Same thing would apply, though, to lot two
quick,
is lot
quick.
Three.
Go ahead.
Looks like the sidewalk is definitely pinched near the stairwell because of the raised or the planting, turf belt, whatever it is, between the sidewalk and the street.
Basically, where we are at this point is the regrading of Deer Street Extension, or it's the road is flattened out, and so the differential between street level, curb level, and the sidewalk level
for that
at least a portion of this is much smoother, and it's, you know, it's closer to the same elevation. It gets more pronounced down here because we've got a low spot out in the street, and that's where, you know, we're at elevation 9 on the street and 12
at
the door.
This wasn't a grading issue that Peter's raising, nor myself this time. It's the sidewalk width, and it looks like it's too narrow at where it meets the parking garage in front of the community space. That's all, not grading related.
Okay, all right.
Okay. All right. Ray, you have something? No? Dave?
A couple comments. Okay. One is we asked for an off-site plan, which I cannot find. So we'll still be looking for that. This plan set is just, it's very difficult for me to read. I just, we're reviewing Building 3 right now. Building 3 is 10% of the white on this page, and the rest of it is off-site stuff that really doesn't have anything to do with Building 3 site. So, I mean, God bless you for being able to pick up all these details, because I can't see any of that on my plan set. I just, you know, we need a blow-up of Building 3, and whatever plan, whatever building you're trying to address in each set should be the focus of that set. And, you know, one overall plan would be okay, but you really should be able to, because a lot of detail that, quite frankly, I just can't see.
Yep.
So,
no, I agree with you, Dave. I think it's a
that point. Seems to be a big problem. One of the things that I need to address today is the fact that, and it was stated, there's a transformer being shown on somebody else's land to address the power needs of the VFW and the city of Portsmouth, which is not addressed. So the traffic signals on Maplewood Avenue both run off that existing pole, part of the overhead system that Deer Street Associates wants to eliminate. So it'll be your job to provide us a transformer for 120, 240 power for both the city's needs and for the VFW somewhere on your site. So that being said, we still need to work through a lot of the details with the sidewalks and stuff.
Yeah. Okay, Eric, did you have anything today?
No.
Okay. So I'm just going to reiterate what Dave started to say. This was a difficult plan set for us to review. I felt it was very drafty. We expect when plans come to TAC that they're ready for us to review and potentially refer to planning board when we receive them. We don't typically assume every project's going to go through multiple TAC sections. And if it does, it's because there's a particular issue that we're trying to resolve, not because we're trying to help you improve your plans. So I'm sorry to sound like I'm lecturing, but it makes our job very challenging, and it's only preparing you for planning board, which, as I said before, really wants to see clarity and wants to know what they're reading when they read these plans without needing some kind of technical specification or engineering degree to do it. So more annotations, isolate the lot so we're not having to see, you know, not trying to identify what this particular lot is compared to all the ones around it. I understand you're trying to put it in context, and there's relationships between different lots in this overall development, but we need to be able to focus on that one lot. There's a lot of things in our site review regs that I think you need to revisit and make sure are covered in each of the sections that are relevant to your team. I think you need to go and make sure that all those notes are there. There's a lot of detail for us to review. We will look at that, but we can't do your work for you. When you next submit your application, please don't submit it as double-sided. We think they're getting, all of us got packets, but we couldn't distinguish between one exhibit to the next because they were all double-sided and one report ran into another. So we appreciate you're trying to save trees, but we need to at least have the reports separated so that we can distinguish what report is associated with what section. So those are my general comments. I think, you know, you can't come back to us until you've gotten the BOA resolved. I think please consider how far along you are before you come back to us. We'll recommend a postponement today, likely, but
I really want to make sure that when you come back to us, your team is ready with all the details we're going to want to review. And certainly, there's specific details you may need to follow up with certain departments directly. That's fine. That's totally fine. But we, as a TAC, need to be able to review this in its completeness with all the details we need. Okay, done with lecture. Sorry about that. I'm now going to open the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come forward, state your name and address. Okay, seeing no one rise, I guess people are waiting for a more complete set. I'll close the public hearing and I'll entertain a motion.
Move to postpone until such time as the zoning is dealt with and the plans are complete.
Okay.
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the next item is also Deer Street Associates, item E. The application of Deer Street Associates owner for property located at 181 Hill Street, Lot 6, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of an existing building and the construction of a five-story mixed-use building, including residential units, a retail bank, office use, retail sales, and a two-level parking garage, with a footprint of 17,973 square feet and gross floor area of 81,498 square feet, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 125 as Lot 17-2 and lies within the CD5 district, the Downtown Overlay District, and the Historic District. This application was postponed at the February 28, 2017 TAC meeting. So same comments from before. If you could just touch on what you really want to communicate to us today and get some feedback on, that would be great.
Okay.
And if you could just give a little overview of this particular lot for those who might be interested in learning more about the project and aren't really sure what's going on.
Okay. This is project is called Lot 6 of the Deer Street development in the garage lot. It's located at 181 Hill Street. The existing site is two residential units and an old garage. The building is a four-story building consisting of a retail space, office, and residential units. It has a below-grade garage that exits off Foundry Place, and it also has a first-floor garage that exits off Hill Street that will house the vehicles for the adjacent property owners who have an easement on that site. There are three parking spaces out front off Hill Street. That two will be normal parking. One spot will be a temporary short-term loading zone, unloading zone for the residential use. The retail space off Foundry Place is split level. It's split between the first floor and the garage floor. There is a walking path between Hill Street and Foundry Place, a proposed crosswalk at the right northeast corner of the lot. Unless there's any questions, I'm going to go on to the changes.
Okay.
We removed a previous design, had a retaining wall on this corner with Redland and Johnson. That has been removed. And we are looking to seek a grading easement from the owner to just do a smooth grade out from the property line. That was previously less than 5 feet wide at the Hill Street corner. Now it's 5+ feet with that wall no longer there. We have added a proposed sign on Foundry Place that will just a caution hidden driveway entrance. because that retaining wall on the back of that existing garage limits the site distance as far as exiting out of the garage onto Deer Street Extension or Foundry Place. I look to the grading plan, grading and drainage plan. One sheet that we have added is that was requested was a easement plan. Mm-hmm. Well, we put a preliminary easement plan in here because we're still in talks with utilities for all the utility changes that have to be made. There were some changes in the drainage since the previous design. There was a revised stormwater report. Unfortunately, I found out yesterday that the wrong report was submitted in the package.
Okay.
It was the previous report.
Okay.
Is it going away?
So I guess the proposed, we decreased the size of the box to keep flows existing going into the Deer Street system, existing system. Then we put part of the roof flow that's currently going to the west towards Brewster Street or towards the existing garage lot, and just to keep flows at existing levels, we're just proposing to just to pipe that existing flow to that side of where it was existing flows going today, just to continue its direction. We also took a pipe out of here that was going across here, the front of the site, to make room for a grease trap for the retail space. Which can be seen on utility sheet in more detail. We also separated the first floor sewer from upper floor sewer.
Okay. Question, did anyone else from your team want to speak to this one? Okay.
Only one update architecturally. We went from 37 mm-hmm. apartments to 43 apartments.
Okay, thanks. Okay, question. I just forgot what I was going to say. I had something to say and I forgot. Questions from TAC members? Same thing from last time?
I got
time?
Red all over the place.
You have a lot of red?
A lot of red.
Okay, so potentially it would be helpful to touch base with Dave?
Yeah, I have. Right. Drainage, Brewster Street. I doubt that any of that water gets to the Brewster Street outfall right now. I find it really hard to believe that it gets that far and goes along the railroad tracks. We don't want the water going there. We do not want the water going to Brewster Street, period. It needs to go to Deer Street. I think I've communicated that to you multiple times. The Hill Street kind of alignment is kind of hokey. It seems like you're putting the curbing in the wrong spot. If you were to kind of envision a 24-foot road through there, I think you can actually pull the curb line away from the building and create wider sidewalks in there. But you need to look at it. Certainly worked with on my sheets, but I'll leave it to you to look at it. That hydrant needs to be moved. There's water services that need to be abandoned that we need to deal with. The underground utility is going to building 191 in order to drop the utility poles. Eversource tells me will not work, cannot be done. Gonna have to either put the transformer for 191 next to the transformer for this building, or you're gonna have to core through the building in another spot and rewire inside the building. I I have multiple pages that are just cut off. There's no title blocks to them at all. The drop manhole that's in the sidewalk is probably going to have to be a 5-foot manhole because it's a very deep drop manhole. So you need to look at that. The hydrant detail had the American Darling instead of the city standard again. And just a lot of stuff. The utilities that are shown on these plans are not up to date with what Ty and Barn is showing currently. So that still needs to get worked through with the underground utilities. And I guess that's the highlights.
Okay, thanks, Dave. I remember what I was going to say. I was going to say this about the other one. You have this note that says plans to be signed and stamped only at time of final submission. So, I mean, that's also concerning to me. I mean, we consider anything that comes to us final submission. So those need to be stamped. Eric, do you have anything?
No, not this time. The concern about the sight line at the Ames building, it's not too great. I mean, there's not going to be a lot of traffic coming up that way. So.
Okay.
But it's a good catch.
Okay. Ray, did I already ask you if you had anything?
No, all set.
Okay, you're good? Okay. Anything else? Nick?
Yeah. Couple small things. Streetscape along Deer Street Extension or Foundry Way?
Foundry Place.
Again, I leave it to those guys down there to ultimately weigh in, but it seems to me, given the lack of volume coming in and out of the garage, the radii on the curbing going out could probably be tightened to be less generous. And I would say if you can't, or we don't want, textured sidewalks going across that apron to get into the garage, that it wouldn't count as community space if it's going to be a paved driveway. So hopefully texturing works, and I know you're looking at it on lot 4. If it works there, it should work here. Then I think it would count. I'm not sure about the transformer being in the community space, but it's not a big issue. It's just a question worth asking. I think looking again, the same comment about the grading and the sidewalk and that turf belt, you got 500 square feet there to maintain with 3 trees and 150 plants. It seems questionable that we want to do that here, at least in my mind.
Well, we'll be looking for an agreement from the applicant. The city won't be maintaining that landscaping.
Okay. In terms of the parking, I wondered if there was any proposal to have public access to the parking spaces on Hill Street, because it looks like it's a private way, and whether there's public access included on the sidewalk on Hill Street because it's a private way. And then just lastly, in terms of the architecture, for what it's worth, it seemed like it would be, there'd be a good opportunity beside the garage door on Foundry Place to maybe introduce some window boxes or something on the blank wall to the right, like we did at 77 State Street, which have parking in behind, but you don't see it. Number two, I wondered if it might be better for the retail space if you chamfered the corner on the ground floor than had it come to, it looks like a point, but maybe I'm reading it wrong. If you pulled it back on the ground floor so you had a better visibility up Foundry Place and Deer Street, it might make it a little bit better. And then it's lastly, seems like the garage door on Hill Street's excessively wide to my eyes. And I don't know, given again, there's not a lot of volume in there, that you need to have what appears to be a super wide door that's going to be on a street that people walk on and drive on now.
Hill Street has kind of a unique situation where it's private property, but it gets used by the public.
Right.
So on the plans, you're showing milling and paving an inch, which, considering the utility work, that you're going to have to abandon all those water services and the sewer lines, seems woefully inadequate. Last time Hill Street got repaved, the city had to do it because you got two different property owners and neither one wanted to pay for it, and yet the road was completely destroyed. And I'm thinking that it would be more than appropriate to ask for a complete reconstruction of Hill Street as part of this project. So
Robert, did you have anything?
This one does have an enclosed garage. I think we mentioned that last time. So you will have to provide location for the generator.
Okay. Carl?
Same comment as before. You need to add the radio strength testing note.
Okay.
I'm good.
Okay. So I think you got your fill of comments from us. I will open up anyone here wishing to speak to for or against this application. Okay, seeing no one rise, I will close the public hearing.
Okay.
I have no idea.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Yes, this one doesn't have any zoning issues, right? So move to postpone.
Move to postpone. Okay, Dave moved to postpone.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. All right, thank you.
Storage?
How do you do stormwater storage?
On the roof.
To the next meeting or indefinite?
Is that
we moved to postpone that one to the next meeting.
Next
yeah.
meeting, okay.
Okay, and I should have mentioned this at the beginning of the meeting. I hope no one's been waiting for Chevrolet Ave. We actually received a request to postpone to the next meeting, but I will read it and I will ask for a vote. New business item F, the application of S&G Realty owner for property located at Chevrolet Ave, requesting site plan approval for demolition of the existing buildings and the construction of a proposed three-unit, three-story residential development with a footprint of 2,426 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 147 as Lot 30 and lies within the general residency district. We received a request to postpone until they have gone in front of the Zoning Board of Adjustment, so they will return next month. I just need a motion for that.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next item, the application of Sacco Professional Building, Inc., owner for property located at 125 Brewery Lane, requesting an extension of the site plan approval to construct a four-story, 64-foot by 240-foot, 15,500-square-foot, 48-unit residential building with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Site plan approval was originally granted on November 17, 2005, and extensions were granted to April 30th, 2017. I don't know, John, this is a weird program that pulled this up, so it's kind of funky. I'm sorry about that.
Dated Microsoft, so it's better.
Okay. I would like to note to the TAC members, and I think the applicant knows this already, this is a request for an extension. We have slightly different consideration for TAC. It comes back to TAC. It's required to come back to TAC. And then we're supposed to review it for basically to see if anything has changed substantially related to traffic, pedestrian access. I'm in a section right now. Traffic flow, pedestrian safety, drainage, water availability, sewer capacity, design standards, landscape elements, and zoning compliance. And then, you know, ultimately this is a planning board's decision, but we can make some sort of recommendation in that regard. So it's a little bit different than, you can obviously look at it like we look at any other site plan. Okay, go ahead, John.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of Technical Advisory Committee, John Chagnon from Ambit Engineering. Here today representing Brewyard Terrace, LLC. King Weinstein, principal partner, is here. Also here are representatives from Chinberg Builders. They have a P&S on the property, and they're looking to take over the project and do the construction. As Juliet mentioned, we are here to extend an existing approval. Again, this approval, as you may know, has been extended a number of times in the past, but we're at a point where we're ready to build, and we would ask your indulgence to take a look and give us a pass to the planning board so that they can hopefully grant another extension to the existing approval so we don't have to start over from the beginning. However, we do understand that the zoning has changed, and part of my presentation will be to show you some things we want to do to enhance the project so that it complies more closely with the CD4W current zoning. Without further ado, the plans were reviewed at the technical advisory workshop. There were a couple of comments that came out of that meeting, and the first related to the, and actually, if you pardon my indulgence, I'd like to hand something out.
Yep. Thanks, John.
Four full size.
Okay, thank you.
Julia, can you give me one of those?
Yes. Anybody else want a full size?
Oh, okay.
So the last page in this handout, if you open up the second of the 11 by 17 plans, is a copy of the utility plan. And the
big plans for you.
Motorola, so-called Motorola note, the repeater note for the building has been updated. We submitted the revised plans on the 30th with a note that is slightly different. This is the most current note, and so that takes care of that comment. The other comments relating to the plan set we heard were the speed hump, and we've updated the note on sheet C4 on the bottom to reference the latest MUTCD standards. We've also changed the paint striping on the plan to reflect that. And we didn't really hear any other comments. Oh, there was one other comment about some landscape elements, and we've replaced those on the plan set. So the plans that you received on the 30th have those minor changes from the workshop. If it's appropriate, I'd like to then go to the zoning analysis work that we've done.
That's fine.
Apologize for handing that in at this last minute, but
we do have it. If you wanted to, I can pull it up. We do have it.
Yeah, that'd be great. Found the machine. So super.
Which one did you want to do?
The
zoning analysis.
So what we did is we developed a matrix that has a number of columns. On the left is the first column on the left are items such as footprint, number of stories, building height, building coverage, minimum open space, community space, sidewalk width, use, and parking. And then we compared the 2005 approval requirements for what was approved in 2005 to the current zoning. It's in character district 4W. These are the base requirements, and these are requirements if you have 20,000 or 20% community space, and if you have 20% community space and workforce housing. So the proposal plan, which is, since we can't put it on the screen, maybe we'll toggle, we'll go through these items and then go to the screen.
Okay.
The red box column shows you the proposal that we are going to be proposing here. It's a little different than the 2005 approval. So the building footprint stays at 15,500. That's the same. We're not changing the building footprint. We're keeping the same building footprint. Allowed in CD4 West is 15,000, so that's 500 square feet over. But with 20% of the lot area dedicated as community space, you can go to 30,000 square feet. And we are going to be in that 20% community space slot. Number of stories is 4. The standard zoning is 2 to 3. But with the 20% community space, we can add a story, and we're shooting for that. The building height, again, it's 49.5. CD4 West is 45 maximum, but if you have the community space, you can go to 55. So we're shooting for that. As far as building coverage goes, 16% from 2005, it's still 16%. We would be allowed to go to 80%, so we're well below that. Open space, we had 41%. We're proposing to keep pretty much the same, but on the plan, we've denoted greater than 32%. 15 is allowed or required, so we are well above the minimum open space. The community space percentage, which allows us to get the bonuses, is 20% required, and we're at 23% with the proposal you'll see in a minute. The sidewalk width, we've expanded, or we propose to expand the sidewalks to 10-foot sidewalks that would come around the site. 12-foot is 5 is the character district, 12 if you go for the bonus. So we'd like a slight variation of 2 feet in that regard. And then as far as the use of the property goes, multifamily, residential, and office are both permitted before and now. And the parking requirement is kind of drove the original approval. We had a requirement for 193, and we showed 193 on the site. Under the CD4 West incentive overlay, we would be maxed out at somewhere between 141 and 155. And we're proposing to cut back the parking to 147. Mm-hmm. So that would be in that sweet spot and open up a lot more of the site to landscaping, as you'll see in a minute. We do have a ground level parking as part of this. It was in the original proposal. We would submit that ground level parking is well shielded from any street view. The Chevrolet Avenue side looks at the first floor, and you access the parking level from the other two sides. So, Juliet, if we could go to the plan. That's dope, that one.
Oops. Sorry. I need a magnifying glass.
It'll take a while to load, I think.
Okay.
Plus up a bit.
You want me to zoom it up? Yeah.
Might help. Okay. Kind of hard to see.
Yeah, it is.
Unfortunately, but the gotta go halfway.
Okay.
I'll go up and down, starting at the top. Oh, that's perfect.
Okay.
Awesome. So the green are spaces that we are going to take over, and they're open spaces and community spaces. So we had a large area of the site that was dedicated to snow storage previously. We're dedicating that to a community, let me get the right words. It would be part of the community space. It's labeled Community Space A, and it's 15,411 square feet. So it extends from the removal of some pavement on the west side, removal of some parking spaces on the south side around that corner. And that is going to be an active urban park. So that would be Community Space A. That space would be accessed over Community Space B, which is a pedestrian access area. So it fits that part of the definition. And that Community Space Area B would extend from the sidewalk that we're going to ring the site with from Chevrolet Ave over to Brewery Lane. It extends over to the park area, and it is at 15 feet wide in all at a minimum in its full length. There is a dedicated raised crosswalk. We widened out a speed hump that was in that location, made it a raised crosswalk. We're going to remove some parking spaces here so that there does need to be traffic crossing there, but we'll put the appropriate pavement markings in, and it will allow access to that urban park. Community space C is the area over here on the south side of the property. The property is bifurcated by Chevrolet Avenue. This space is already in a conservation easement, so we're showing it as a park area, a natural area. And note three of the plan set, or the plan, sorry, totals up the areas of the 15,411 for area A, 6,992 area B, and the 25,496 square feet for C. Gives us a total of 23% of the property, which would be community open space. So that comports to the minimum 20% that we talked about on the table. As a matter of reference, we're also taking areas of parking and turning them into open space. So we would provide an area here. This one, this whole row of parking would be removed and replaced with the landscape area. We would take out this parking to provide for a turning movement around the end of this aisle, take out all this parking here, which would be more green space. There's a green space area here, which had been a loading zone. That was one of the other comments from workshop, that we put that back to lawn. There's an open space area in front of the building along the Chevrolet Avenue side, and two other open space areas. And those open space areas, when you add them into the community open space, give you a total open space of 32% for the site. The other thing to note about the plan is the public access easement area. So we're proposing to provide public access to the property line in Chevrolet Avenue and the associated sidewalk, coming around all the way over to Brewery Lane and further to connect. It is a rather odd configuration. That section of Brewery Lane is not owned by the city. It's owned by the lot owner. Mm-hmm. Same with Chevrolet Avenue. So it's all a part of the lot, but we will be dedicating a public access easement area. We did take out the planting strip along Chevrolet Avenue, widen the sidewalk to 10 feet, which was another good suggestion to help us meet the CD4 zoning requirements. The 12-foot is preferred, but given the amount of traffic, we would ask that the 10 be appropriate. We could extend that 10-foot around the it kind of ends at this point here currently. Due to some site grading issues and site design issues, we really didn't have time to redo that, but certainly if that was carried forward to planning board, we would be able to put the time in to show that, mm-hmm. and that would be appropriate to have a 10-foot sidewalk all the way over here. We eliminated some street parallel parking here and show a bike stand, ride share space. That would be enough for, I believe it's two 10 bike racks. And we would like some feedback on whether we bring the sidewalk straight down, create a new sidewalk line and put those on the sidewalk, or if you'd rather have them on the pavement side. Right now they're on the pavement side, and we show the sidewalk coming up and then going back to the street edge. But I'd like some feedback on whether it would be appropriate to be on top of the sidewalk or in the street.
Okay.
That pretty much sums up what we have for you today.
Okay. All right, thank you. Any questions from Tech? Go ahead, Nick.
Sure. First off, good job, John, in pulling this together in short order and looking with a critical eye at the character-based zoning. I think you did a really good job enumerating both the open space on the site and the proposed community space. Just a couple of quick comments for you guys to consider. The Community Space Area A, which is that 15,000 square foot park, I know that you haven't had time to program it, and you've got to do it right, and you've got to think about all the buildings that you've got down there in that neighborhood. But I wouldn't discourage you from having active uses go into that space if they're suitable for your clientele or for the folks that are in the neighborhood. I can see anything from a small playground, with a seating area. I don't even think a half court basketball hoop is a bad idea for the kinds of people that might be moving into your units. Bocce, whatever, swing set. You know, I'm looking at the images and they seem pretty passive. That's just an opinion of one that you might want to look at some active uses, or at least here we're not in opposition to that, should you come to that conclusion. In terms of your conversion of parking into landscape or open space areas, I think it's fantastic. And I would just ask you to consider, this is a very minor point, but at the top of the site there, near the dumpsters, it looks like you removed 3 parking spaces on each side, so 6 up there at the top. Seems like you could get away with only 4 being removed and still be able to circulate in both directions, and then create a protective island that protects that first parking space on the right-hand side. I don't know what direction I'm pointed, but having the islands at the end, you know, the long landscape strip, I think you should try and have a protective sort of L or return, over protecting the cars on that other side. It seems like you could do it there without removing any more parking. But maybe I'm reading it wrong. The same at the very bottom of that long line down near Chevrolet Ave. Seems like, again, you've got this long rectangular landscaped island. I would encourage you to have a return on the right-hand side for the first parking space. Small point. I would encourage you, if it's not already being done, to have vertical granite curbing along the backs of these buildings. Rather, the slope just doesn't hold up and won't work as well and doesn't protect the pedestrian. You've got a sidewalk right along the back of building C and B. Maybe it's vertical, I just didn't see it. The lawn area that used to be the loading, I don't know what your opportunities are for rain gardens or some kind of stormwater management, but it would be good to look at those new landscape areas for some stormwater treatment. Then the last comment I think I have 2 more. The 5-foot sidewalk on Chevrolet Ave or whatever the roadway is, once you turn the corner, I don't know what it's called, at the bottom of that site plan, I see you've got a 5-foot wide sidewalk. I think you should try and get that up to 10 like the rest. If you said that, I missed it. But if you've got 10 going around the perimeter, at least, I would think we'd want to carry that up to Brewery Lane. And then lastly, I'd ask you to consider taking the 2 dumpsters that are in the same place the old plan had, which is the terminal vista from Brewery Lane and Jewel Court. You look right through the site, you're going to look at a dumpster enclosure at the far end. Maybe the grading makes it impossible to see, I can't tell. But it seems like you could move those 2 dumpsters a little bit further away from the building. Yes, they'll have to walk a little bit further, but put them at the end of the double-loaded parking bay next to the open space. The truck would still be able to drive down the middle of the parking and unload them, and then you could landscape that terminal vista and integrate it, unless there's walls, into the other. Oh, sorry, that's another site. But landscape that back edge. So that's all I have.
Thanks. Anybody else?
A couple quick things. I would encourage the applicant to work with the Malt House Exchange. The back of their property is kind of paved and broken glass right now. They might be interested in kind of upgrading that if they didn't have any. I think it would make that park look a lot better. If it actually ended at a building instead of another paved area. Mm-hmm. LEDs, the lighting that's shown is metal halide. It's not 2005 anymore, so maybe we can update that to modern standards. And last thing, John, sheet D3, doghouse catch basin installation over existing main. Probably not going to let you do that. I know it was on the previously approved plan, but probably put a regular catch basin in there with the appropriate sump.
Okay. Anything else?
Okay. We'll have a public hearing. Oh, go ahead, Eric. Yep.
John, you're showing a raised crosswalk here, which is one of your speed humps. But if it's a raised crosswalk, it needs to be wider than the typical speed hump.
In the detail, yes. Yep.
Yeah, well, the detail shows it as being 12 feet wide, but if it's a raised crosswalk, it should be 22. We should have a 10-foot flat surface in the middle.
Yeah, in the plan view, it's wider, but I'll make two details.
Okay.
Hey, Eric, while you're there, I missed one of my notes on here. Mm-hmm. What do you think of the idea between building B and C, where you have a speed hump on the prior approval, replacing that with a raised crosswalk so all the people in the backs of those two buildings can get across there without the speed hump? Just have two raised crosswalks in the site.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
Yeah. It has to be wider, but
yeah there's room work. For it, I think.
You know, and make sure drainage works. And
well, you got a speed hump there anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the drainage has got to work anyway.
Yeah. I don't know if fire has an opinion on it, but
it's probably easier to get over a raised crosswalk.
Do you like
than
raised
speed
crosswalks
hump.
Better than speed humps?
Yeah.
In general?
Yeah. Yes. He loves it.
You can tell.
Okay, thanks, Eric. And I guess the feedback I'd give you on the bike share station is that our plan is to have a, you know, we're doing a bike share program with Zagster, which is a lease. So I would suggest that probably having a sidewalk there that we could put the bike share station on, and then you're not left if for some reason we relocate that bike share station or don't continue it in the future. You have some flexibility with that space. It's not just a paved area.
Or it could be moved down where they're showing. Looks like there's three hatch spots. Is that first one?
I think you were saying the three hatch spots would be enough room for the bike station. That was
correct.
All for
there'd
bikes.
Be 60 feet.
Bike
so,
yeah. Not just one, but that whole area.
Because it looks like there's an island down at the corner. I mean, you could even slide them that way towards the corner. The bike share could serve as the raised island at the corner.
Right.
Seems like it's better the closer you get to the corner in order to see it from
visibility.
The Hannafords and everyone.
Yep.
Yeah.
So I guess my recommendation is that you actually extend the sidewalk and continue that down through those parking spaces. And
you'd
then
want
you
a wide sidewalk so you can walk behind the Zagster.
Yep. And we can provide you with the dimensions of the clearance and stuff, but I think you'll have.
I think you've got that on there. Looks like you've got 9 feet wide on those. So.
Yeah. Yeah. I got the.
So you'll have you'll have 5 feet of clearance. It'll be fine. Mm-hmm.
Just unsure of what you mean about move the bike rack south?
Yes.
Yes.
So it's more visible from the,
Okay. I just worry about the vehicle clearance and plowing and view, but we'll work on that.
Well, as long as it's 9 feet wide, and I think that's like what, Eric, is it typically like 18 inches back from the edge of the street?
18 inches from the curb,
yeah.
Pulling it out into the street, you need 3 feet. Or you put it out towards the street and pull back 3 feet from the curb.
Yep. We can give you some specs for that.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
All right, so I'm going to open up the public hearing. Anyone here who wants to speak to, for, or against this application? Okay, see no one rise. Close the public hearing. Okay, so as I mentioned before, we're thinking about this in the context of an approval. It's slightly different. I mean, a request for an extension. Just looking at what I had drafted as a potential. I mean, basically, your motion should just, whoever makes the motion should just indicate whether we feel that anything has material changed to impact the previous approval, and if anything has materially changed, the applicant has made an effort to address those changes and improve the overall plan in terms of compliance and utility capacity and parking and so forth and traffic.
I'd make a motion to recommend the planning board strongly consider extending this permit with maybe stipulations or conditions or recommended stipulations, not quite sure how to word that for the mm-hmm. planning board, but that the applicant consider revising the plans per the comments today regarding the landscaping, The community space areas provide easements to go with those to the city. You know, adjust the sidewalk, make sure it's vertical granite curbing, make sure those raised crosswalks work dimensionally, address the Zagster bike station location as discussed. And consider LID, low impact development drainage systems in those, some of those landscape areas that you're creating out of the parking, and relocation of the dumpster if feasible. Otherwise, I think it's substantially better than what was approved in whenever it was approved.
Okay, want to just reiterate what you?
I'll second it. And add the LED luminaires,
yep.
Working with the property owner next door, and the removal of the doghouse catch basin detail. It'll be a normal catch basin.
Right. Okay. All right. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay.
Juliet, I have to go to my meeting.
Okay. All right, so next item is the item H, the application of Marine J. Arsenal, Marine J. O'Leary, owner for property located at 107 McKinley Road, requesting preliminary and final subdivision approval to subdivide one lot into two lots as follows. Proposed lot number one having an area of 16,955 square feet and 78.19 feet of continuous street frontage on McKinley Road and 181.81 feet of continuous street frontage on Grant Avenue. Proposed lot number two having an area of 15,245 square feet and 66.89 continuous street frontage on McKinley Road and 171.17 feet of continuous street frontage on Coolidge Drive. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 251 as Lot 67. And lies within the single residence B district where the minimum lot area is 15,000 square feet and the minimum continuous street frontage is 100 feet. Hello.
Hi. Thank you for the work you do. It's been very interesting this afternoon.
All right, so all I ask is you just quickly describe your project, and as we mentioned in the work session, there's probably not that much that we're gonna have to add.
I'm just subdividing the property where I have enough square footage and enough road frontage.
Great, thank you. Okay, any questions from TAC? Eric, did you have something?
No, for the record, are you building or are you just subdividing?
I'm subdividing right now. I'm deciding whether I'm going to build or not.
All right, I'm just pulling up your... okay, anybody else? Any questions? Concerns? Okay, no questions or comments. Then I'm gonna open up a public hearing. Anyone here wishing to speak to, for, or against this application? Seeing no one rise, I will close the public hearing and I will entertain a motion.
Move to recommend this to the planning board.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any discussion? Okay, you're all set. Thanks for coming. Right. Okay, next item is item J, the application of Peter Frigo and Westwind Townhomes of Portsmouth Condominium Association owner for property located at 1177 and 1179 Sagamore Avenue. Requesting site plan approval for demolition of an existing structure and the construction of three new condominium dwelling units, two separate buildings, seven total units, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 224 as lots 12 and 13 and lies within the Mixed Residential Office MRO District.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the Second Advisory Committee, John Chagman, Manifit Engineering. representing 1179 Sagamore Avenue, LLC. The principal is not, he's traveling today, he's not with us, but we can proceed. The plan...
Sorry, hold on, John, I just have to... See if it lets me open it with Adobe this time. Try that.
Oh, there you go.
Yay. Okay. Cancel. Eric, if you want to make that full size, feel free. All set. Go ahead.
So, the property is under consideration is actually two lots, 1177 and 1179 Sagamore Avenue, and they are outside, south of the Sagamore Creek Bridge, just before you get to Odeon Point Drive on the west side of Sagamore Avenue. Currently, there's a condominium, four-unit condominium that is on a northerly lot, and the proposal is to add to this condominium by taking the lot to the south, 1179 Sagamore Avenue, and attaching it to the condominium. Currently, there's a single-family home on that lot, has a driveway, turnaround, some septic system in the back, and that would all be demolished. Again, the condominium that exists on the top would be expanded. The pavement here would be removed to allow for a new joint driveway. All of this driveway would be removed, the house, the septic system, all of the components that are on that lot now. And in its place, there would be a three-unit condominium, or three units would be added to the condominium, so it's an expansion of the existing condominium. It'd be a two-unit building closer to Sagamore Avenue, and then a standalone one unit in the back. It would be accessed by a driveway. There would be parking interior to each unit, two spaces inside a garage, so it would be all off-street garage parking. There's some existing hedge. There's an existing hedge here between the two properties that we would transplant about 5 or 10 feet to the north, to the best of our abilities. There's some additional landscaping that would be planted. Utilities would come from an existing sewer connection, which would be added to. There would be a new utility drop for electrical power. There would be water coming off of Sagamore Avenue, and drainage would be handled with drip strip edge of building infiltration and a collection system that would have an overflow to some new drainage in the edge of the road from a catch basin that will be placed here down to connecting with the existing drainage infrastructure at the Odeon Point Road intersection. There's a grading and erosion control plan showing more detail about the grading and the erosion control. It's going to be leveled out. The site would be pretty flat. There would be some exposure on the back side of the building, so there's some retaining walls shown on the south side that would raise the grade and allow you to flatten out the lot between the higher side and the lower side. The off-site drainage connects down to the catch basin at the Odeon Point Road intersection. There are the usual details. The plans were revised from your comments at the workshop, showing the off-site drainage, adding additional detail about the pavement to be removed at the entrance. We are showing some sidewalk to be constructed along Sagamore Avenue, adding sloped curbing at the entrance. We showed a revised parking analysis and adjusted some of those notes so that they are all in line with the plans. Put a note on there about additional approval for a combined sprinkler and domestic water service, which we would like to do. Noted that they we're proposing that be combined, changing the sewer pipe sizes. And that pretty much covers. There's some miscellaneous things we did on the detail sheets. But hopefully we've addressed all your questions from last week. And if there's any questions today or any other explanation needed, I'd be glad to assist.
Okay, thank you, John. Questions from TAC?
Some more questions, I got some comments.
Comments, go ahead, Dave.
Okay, John, drainage going to Tucker's Cove. We're envisioning that that was gonna be under the sidewalk, so it wouldn't need to be tearing up the state road.
Okay.
And there is a note on here that says that the city of Portsmouth is going to require the easement. I think that's not what we meant. So this condition is contingent on you guys getting the easement, put the sidewalk in. We'll also need an easement from the same condo to extend all the way to the northern property line for future sidewalk extension by the city.
Okay.
So that easement should probably be back at least 10 feet from the property line in order to deal with slope issues that are going to be in there.
Correct.
Slope issues.
Yeah, we'll have a sidewalk and a slope easement going north of the driveway. I think the intent of that note was just to say that the applicant will approach the abutter in good faith, but he can't make
it. So that note, can you just, what sheet you're on?
On sheet C5, yep. Near the right side of the sheet.
Okay, thank you.
So if you're not able to get the sidewalk easement, you'll have to come back, basically.
What's that?
If you're not able to get the sidewalk easement, you'll have to come back, and we'll have to discuss things.
Back to TAC. That could be a condition, maybe. Going forward.
Okay. Any other comments or questions from you, Dave?
Ray, you want to talk about water services?
Yeah, I think what we talked about last time, having a water service, the city would need the ability to shut off the water service, domestic water, without shutting off the fire protection service to the buildings. But that doesn't appear to be the way it's shown.
Well, that was the thought of having a combined sprinkler domestic, getting a waiver. Obviously, if you...
Yeah, the problem with the combined
yep.
is that we cannot shut the water off for non-payment without shutting off the fire protection.
Correct.
So we need something that shows two shutoffs outside the structure mm-hmm. so that we can shut off only the domestic and not the fire protection.
Okay. So we could bring it up to the structure and then tee it off and have two shutoffs. Is that what I'm hearing? Is that acceptable?
Yes, that's what you're hearing.
Okay.
And last time we talked about having a blanket easement.
Yes.
For the properties.
Yes.
Both property. Well, it would be one property for the both developments. The older one and the new one. Yep.
Right. Gotcha. Yeah, we forgot to put the note on that plans about the blanket easement. Thank you.
Anything else, Ray?
Just had a question. The existing sewer that you're tying into, any idea what the pipe size is and the condition?
It's 8-inch, it's new.
No, that? Okay. It's just not noted on the plan.
Yeah, no, they put that in like 5 years ago.
Okay.
So want them to add that?
Yeah. That information, where it's tying into and going towards the city system.
Okay. Okay. Anything else? Eric, any comments?
Not this time, no.
All right. Any comments from your end of the table? Robert? Carl?
John, C3 was not updated, so there's no reference in the plan anywhere to the sprinkling requirement, regardless of how the water line issue comes out there. It needs to be clearly annotated and documented on here that
Right. That
those three buildings are going to be sprinkled.
Yeah, the note number four should be updated, right? It says additional approval required for proposed combination of sprinkler water services. That should be changed, right? C3.
Right.
Yeah.
That didn't get to some folks. We never got the updated plans.
Oh, really? Oh, I'm sorry. Did anybody else not get them?
It's okay.
Okay, we do have extra copies here. Sorry, should have let me know that. Sorry about that.
So the new note's okay?
That's okay, but you're right. It never got changed.
Okay.
Yep.
No, just let me know.
All right. Peter, do you have comments?
Yeah. So there's no landscape plan. I'm assuming the site layout plan is supposed to serve as that?
Yes.
I don't know if that needs a waiver.
I think you need to provide a separate landscape plan or you need a waiver.
And there's really not much in the way of landscaping. I don't know if that's because it's already landscaped or you're leaving stuff. It's hard to tell. But I know it's pretty packed with development, but it'd be nice to see a little more landscaping if you could get it on there. And the other thing, there's no statement about the green building, according to the ordinance, talking about how it's a sustainable development or not.
Right.
It has to be addressed. And I had a question, probably most importantly, about the stormwater, and maybe I'm just reading the plans wrong, but when I look at the site, the southeast corner of the site, it seems like there's going to be a big puddle there. How's that going to, can water move through that retaining wall? Or how's the water going to get out from that southeast corner of the site? Because it looks like it's all graded. Everything goes into the drip edges. I see that, except for that southeast corner where the driveways come together, and then there's a retaining wall. Is that just going to turn into a big puddle there? Or is there some provision for that I'm not understanding? It looks like you're smoothing it out a little bit with the new grading, but it's still the low point.
I don't know if you want to. I'm going to have Doug LaRosa from Ambit who did the grading.
Okay, thank you, Doug.
Good afternoon. So there will, on the detail sheet, J on sheet B2, it shows the retaining wall.
Yep.
And generally, it's graded so that the water will go right over the retaining wall. Also, a retaining wall is built so that it has stone behind it. Way in front of the retaining wall is very permeable. And as you go through the retaining wall, it goes into a footing. And through the footing, there's weep holes at the bottom of the wall. So that water would not get trapped. It would be able to infiltrate front of the wall or drip over it.
So the retaining wall is just a flush edge of the parking lot the driveway?
It's a little bit lower, actually.
It's a little lower than the driveway.
Yeah, we have the grade shown on the
top
of the wall.
I see that. It says 39 and then it says 40.
Right.
And I guess I didn't catch that top and bottom, but does that mean that, is there a curb there then? What keeps you both?
There's no curb there, no.
But there's a 7-foot drop off the edge, is there? How do you stay on that site?
Is there a fence?
That's erosion control, or is that a fence?
So on the grading plan, C4, it shows that it's graded away. Yes, so.
Is that a guardrail on the corner there?
No. So where are we talking about on this?
Yeah, that is a curb rail.
Southeast corner.
Southeast corner, right, is higher than the driveway. So you're not going to go go off the driveway, the wall is up above. As you're going in the entrance to the left.
It says 40 on the grading, right? Less than below 40?
It says the bottom is 38, the top's 40. So it's a 2-foot high wall. You're not going to slide off the driveway because it's uphill. It's 2 feet above the drive. Are we on the same page?
It looks like the grading shows that that driveway around the corner there is 40. That is a driveway, right? Or is that just a wall?
No, that's a.
Is that a landscape area?
It's just
there?
Open
that's
space.
All,
right?
That's all open space.
Open space.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's open space, and then it goes to the wall, which is about the same level as the open space, and then
right.
It's a 7-foot drop. And the water just runs right off the edge there?
It either infiltrates through the above the wall down into the stone that's built along the face of the wall, or it will go over the top. Yeah. But it's a small area. So we're talking a very small amount of water.
Okay.
It's a
big
20
drop.
By 20. It's, you know, it's not that big an area. And that's where the water goes now.
Okay. Yeah, I see that. I guess it just seems like a interesting transition there and a big drop off.
It's a retaining wall. It will look nicely landscaped when it's finished.
Well, we can't see any of that.
Yeah.
It just looks like a blank area.
It's a gently graded area that will be lawn.
Do we need a fence there?
Isn't there a fence on top of it? Is that a guardrail?
No, there's no fence on top of it.
Isn't it? It says top of wall, bottom, 39 to 32. Right? Isn't that 6.5 feet?
Yes.
This was a fence.
39 to 30. So you're talking about behind the building?
Yes.
Okay, so that there is a fence there, yes.
Okay. Good.
Yeah, that's what those little squares are.
That symbol is a fence?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Says
just a wild goose chase to make sure we're all, and not me, I guess, awake.
Oh, it's a fence. It's a 5-foot vinyl fence.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't catch that.
Well, it's on another plan. That's why. Okay. Other questions? Okay. I had some comments. Are you proposing to create a new curb cut?
Expanding the existing curb cut.
So you're getting rid of the one that goes to the, okay, and the other one you're just going to reuse?
Correct.
Okay.
We have a permit app into New Hampshire DOT.
Okay. On sheet C2, note number 4, I was a little confused about that. The purpose of this plan is to show a conceptual layout for the addition of 3 dwelling units on a proposed combined lot. Existing utilities are approximate and will be field verified. Where possible, drainage should be detailed as the design progresses. That seems very vague to me for us to...
Yep, that's a leftover from the TAC workshop phase.
Thank you. So you'll take that off. you have on your approval notes, on number 2, it's the intent, but we have updated language in our ordinance now. So just check section 2.5.42E for that. Just says something about in perpetuity and, yeah. 2.5.42E.
Okay. And is that on the cover sheet, that note about the, or is it, oh, it's on sheet
C2
also.
It's on sheet
C2.
It's the approval notes, number 2.
Approval
note.
Okay.
And then, John, I know you double-checked the setbacks and stuff, but I'm confused because on the front of the site, there's what appears to be a 14.5-foot setback
mm-hmm.
from the lot line, but you're saying that the front setback is 21.29. So I just... wondering where that other number came from. Am I reading that correctly? It's 14.5 is the actual front. That's the front setback.
Yes.
Okay. So just make that match your table.
Yep.
And on the rear, it says 16.5, and your table says 16.74. It's minor, but it just confused me. Oh. What are you guys going to do about? Is it trash pickup? Are you just going to have someone come into the site to pick up trash, or how is that going to work?
unfortunately, the applicant isn't here, but I believe that with four units, I don't know that they would be doing curbside now. I'm not sure. Obviously, seven units is going to be more.
It's going to be combined with the other units, though. It's one
yep.
lot.
Yep.
It's going to be more volume.
So what happens? Do you know what happens now?
Bring it to the end of
it. Do they wheel it out to the curb?
They may.
Okay.
I know there's a volume limitation for any site, so.
Okay, so maybe you could answer that
we
question.
We can answer that yes. question on the plan, and I would assume the answer would probably be a private trash pickup
okay.
service.
All right, so just answer that. I'll do my notes. There were no building elevations, so that needs to be added to the plan set. So required, we do require building elevations.
Yeah, here. They were in eight, they're not in the plan set. They were submitted.
No.
Yeah, they were submitted.
Did anyone else get plan elevations? No.
They're 8.5 by 11. Michelle Shields, architect, sure.
We did not get anything unless, yeah. Did you get something? I don't get anything.
I thought I remember what I was seeing.
It wasn't in my packet. Was that submitted with a, no, I didn't.
They were submitted with the original application.
Okay, that's the problem. We didn't carry those. Some of us didn't bring those to the next meeting.
I think Nick got them all.
Nick got them all? Okay.
Nick got them.
It's all right. We'll take a look at them.
Okay.
All right, that was it. Any outdoor lighting that you're going to be adding to the site?
No.
Okay.
Nope.
Okay, those are all my questions. Anyone else? Okay, I'll open the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application? Seeing no one rise, I'll close public hearing. Okay, what do people feel like? There, some work needs to be done still.
What did you guys have? I had
the water, yeah, the water service. Yours are minor. There was notes, drainage.
Anything you need to review?
Landscaping?
We do need a landscaping
I'd like
plan.
To see a landscaping plan. I mean, yeah. It'd be nice to see it, but I think we could probably. It's not that big a site if you put a plan in and brought it to the planning board.
Yep.
We can give comments.
Yep.
I don't think the comments are that significant.
No. Okay. No. So I welcome anybody want to make a motion to move it along, and if you
I recommend approval with at least from me the statement about the green building requirements, the landscape plan. You guys had
sidewalk, easements.
We need a second too.
Right. So let's get
a second.
I'll second it.
Okay. All right. So far we have the lead statement, or the sustainability statement. Separating out the landscaping and adding more landscaping.
Yeah, more landscaping, landscape plan.
Which I think probably would be good to submit to the planning department for us to take a look at before you go to final.
Yeah, I can review it before the planning board memo gets completed.
Okay.
The easement for the future sidewalk to the north
of
the driveway, and then
construction of the sidewalk to the south.
Construction of the sidewalk from the south, which will require an easement from the abutter. So if that can't be secured, then we'll have to revisit
relocation
that.
Of the drainage under the sidewalk.
Put the drainage under the sidewalk, okay. Mm-hmm.
And the water service connection.
Yeah.
Domestic and fire.
Yep. Blanket easement for the water service, is that correct?
Whole
access?
Property.
Okay. Mm. And that's water service access, right? Or is it more than that? Okay.
It's access to shutoffs and also leak detection. Anything else we would need to go on the property for?
City easement. Noting the existing sewer connection, right? And Carl, the update to the note.
Yes.
And I made a correction to that note too, the site note, which you and you'll fix that stuff.
I wrote
okay,
those.
So minor corrections as well, which you caught.
Yep.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, we're all set.
Thank you very much.
All right, you're welcome. Okay. All right. Item K, the application of Portsmouth Submarine Memorial Association owner for property located at 600 Market Street, requesting site plan approval to construct a 20 by 40 storage building with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 209 as Lot 87.
and lies within the single residence B districts.
Good afternoon, John Shagnon from Ambit Engineering, representing the Portsmouth Submarine Memorial Association. I apologize for the lateness, but we do have some revised building plans.
Okay. Well, let me get out, Eric.
Need to see these.
Get out. Windows. Thank you. Go ahead, John. You don't have to wait for me.
Okay. So the property is property of the Portsmouth Submarine Memorial Association. It's also known as Albacore Park, and it's on the Route 1 bypass adjacent to Market Street Extension.
My goodness, what the heck is that?
Click the X up in the corner.
There we go. So you have the Albacore Park. Sub is here, the bypass here. There's a newly named or will be named a submarine way, that connector road that was put in at one time. And the Market Street Extension is here. And the Leslie Drive neighborhood is back over here. So the park desires to have some additional storage, and there's a couple of plans showing the existing conditions. And simply put, the application before you is a small commercial building that would be placed at the south west end of the existing parking area. Some pavement would be removed, and a smooth little parking area here would be left. The building would be constructed. It would be for storage. The only utility that would service it is electric, which would be fed from the building. And that's pretty much the totality of the application. We have some revised building elevations for the board. The project was reviewed at your workshop, and there were some good comments. We adjusted the erosion control measures to protect the wetlands that are north of the proposed building. So we added some wetland silt sock protection, or some erosion control silt sock protection for that wetland. We added a note about loaming and seeding disturbed areas where the pavement was going to be removed. The applicants took to heart some suggestions from Nick Cracknell, which you see in the revised plans, also reorientating the building. And we did add a note that the Portsmouth Submarine Memorial Association will fix or work with the city to realign the sewer easement. There is a sewer easement. Some work was done recently, and the sewer was relocated. So there's a note on the plan that the city will get the final easement, that will be done. And I think that's all that came out of that workshop. It's a pretty simple proposal. I'd be glad to answer any questions you have.
Okay. Any questions?
I just have one comment. Yep. On the new drawings, John. Mm-hmm. Step to the bottom of the footing is 4 feet below grade. Not 3 feet. Why is that? In the cross section.
Can you say that again, right. Robert? I can't hear you.
You'll have to go down 4 feet, not 3 feet below grade.
Okay. So. Yep.
Any other questions or comments?
I have a question. Is there a drip edge around this building, John? There is a drip edge around the building.
1 foot overhang.
You mean, is there a soffit or is there a drip edge?
On the ground.
On the ground.
Wait for the water to go in, or is it just?
Yeah, we're not showing a drip edge. It's such a small building, we just anticipate it would go into the lawn.
And it's all lawn down to the wetland there?
Correct. Well, it's some scrub growth. Scrub growth.
I'll be all right.
Okay.
Yeah, there's pavement there now, so.
Yeah, right?
John, you said you added that note. Where is that? What sheet?
I thought we added the note. Let's see. I think if you look in the vicinity of the sewer line on sheet C2, it says, City of Portsmouth sewer easement, relocate to new location. Just below the sub, the east end of the sub.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Did you find it?
Yes, but is that the...
relocate the easement. I mean...
They need to provide a plan showing the easement.
Yes. So that would be a suitable condition that the PSMA provide you with an easement plan that can be recorded, yes, showing the...
Okay.
That's fine. And that was the intent, and they're fully...
It says relocate the...
Right, but they need...
It says relocate the easement.
Relocate what?
Yeah. It says relocate the easement, but it doesn't say...
Provide us with a quotable plan to do that, right?
That would be a condition that would be appropriate.
Okay. Yep. All right. Anyone here to speak to for or against this application? Seeing no one rise, close public hearing.
Make a motion to recommend this to the planning board. Stipulation that the sewer easement get dealt with.
Yep. Second. Any discussion? Robert, did you want to add that elevation comment?
I'll do it during plan review.
Okay. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, the next two items are, I would recommend that we hear them together. Would anybody make a motion we hear them together and vote on them separately?
So moved.
Second.
Yep.
Okay. The items are, so I'm going to read them in together and then we'll hear from the applicant. Item 11, the application of Borthwick Forest LLC, KS, Borthwick LLC, and HCA Realty, Inc. owners, and Borthwick Forest LLC applicant for property located off Borthwick Avenue and WBBX Road, requesting preliminary and final subdivision approval to combine four lots into one lot and create a new public right-of-way as follows, to consolidate the following four lots. A, lot 24 is shown on assessor map 241, having an area of 22.8 acres. Lot 26 is shown on assessor map 241, having an area of 4.9 acres. Lot 113 is shown on assessor map 233, having an area of 13.8 acres. Lot 1112 is shown on assessor map 233, having an area of 0.7 acres, into a single lot containing 42.2 acres, or 0.3 acres. And two, to create a public right-of-way from Borthwick Avenue to the consolidated lot as follows. A, following a reserved right-of-way across land of HCA Realty, Inc., assessor map 234, lot 7-4A, having an area of 44,032 square feet. B, following a right-of-way across land of Boston and Main Corporation, assessor map 165, lot 14, having an area of 5,457 square feet. And C, extending into the consolidated lot with an area of 31,657 square feet, thereby reducing the area of the consolidated lot to 41.5 acres, said proposed public right-of-way having a total area of 81,146 square feet and total length of approximately 1,000 feet. Said properties lie within the office research district where the minimum lot area is 3 acres and the minimum continuous street frontage is 300 feet. Item M, the application of Borthwick Forest LLC and KS Borthwick LLC owners and Borthwick Forest LLC applicant for property located on proposed subdivision road to be created off Borthwick Avenue and off BBX Road, requesting site plan approval to construct a 50,000 square foot office building with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, fire access drive, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on assessor map 241 as lots 25 and 26, and assessor map 233 is lots 112, 113, and 114, and lies within the office research and single residence B districts. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the committee. I'm Patrick Kermans with Ty and Bond. Also here with me today for the project team is Rob Chindell, the project attorney, and Jason Plord, the traffic engineer. As the chairman just read into the record, we are here today for a recommendation of approval to the planning board for a subdivision and also a site plan approval related to a 50,000 square foot office building with associated site improvements.
Just trying to find the plans. Which one? I'm not seeing.
102 is the overall site.
B102? I can't see any of it.
I can't see that far.
It almost doesn't look like you're on here, which would be weird.
Scroll down.
That's just very strange. Hold on. I can try to get online. Go ahead and proceed with your presentation. I'll fill
sure. So the project will involve a lot consolidation and re-subdivision. Actually, I should start from the beginning. As you're aware, this project has been in front of the city in many forms over the last decade or so. The latest was a project that we had before you folks for several months that had received a recommendation for approval to the planning board that included a bridge design and brought the road from Borthwick Avenue through to Islington Street. The planning board did deny that request, and currently the project is in the court system. We are currently have an appeal at the Supreme Court, but our hope is with this latest design is actually to get that out of the court system. We believe this design has addressed a number of the concerns that were raised at the planning board with respect to the bridge, the connection through to Islington Street, and then there was a question of some of the that raised with the unknown. So here we are proposing a 50,000 square foot office building as part of this project. So that's just a quick overview on where we are today here. We will be consolidating four lots that are currently bound by railroad right-of-ways, map 241 lot 25, map 241 lot 26, map 233 lot 113, and 233-112. Those will be merged and then re-subdivided with a city right-of-way. As I mentioned, the land is bound by the railroad tracks, so to access the road, to access those parcels, we'll be constructing a city road that will connect from Borthwick Avenue. We'll come across an existing 80-foot reserve right-of-way that's located on map 234, lot 7-4A, and an existing railroad crossing easement that both currently benefit Borthwick Forest and would be deeded to the city of Portsmouth. So going to the site plan, what that will be is a 1,000 linear foot road coming off of Borthwick Avenue to a cul-de-sac that is 50 foot radius. That is the minimum dimension that's required by the subdivision regulations. Access off of Borthwick and the multi-use path design that's shown here was what was previously approved as part of the road that had previously gone through, no longer does. Working our way down the road from Borthwick Avenue, we'll get to that existing railroad crossing easement. We cannot move from that existing railroad crossing easement. We tried to do that previously, and that would have required a bridge. As I mentioned, we did not make it through planning board with a bridge design, and thus we're back here before you folks. And certainly moving it to the east wouldn't work because that'll require further wetland impacts and wetland buffer impacts. I will mention, since I'm talking about this easement, we do need a conditional use permit as well from the planning board. Because of the location of the existing railroad crossing easement, we cannot avoid buffer impacts. We have submitted the application to CONCOM. We actually have a site walk with them tomorrow and are on their agenda for next week. So coming across the railroad tracks, we'll head down towards the cul-de-sac, and then that will be where the site is situated, a 50,000 square foot office building located primarily where the existing or the former WBBX radio station parcel is located. The length of road as I mentioned, is 1,000 feet. The road will require a waiver from the subdivision regulations because it exceeds 1,000 feet. So we will be submitting that to the planning board as part of our final package when we receive recommendation for approval from you folks. To address the concern and that waiver, we have provided emergency access off of Islington Street as well. That in the event that there was no opportunity to get to the proposed office building from Borthwick Avenue, should the road be blocked or the tracks, we have provided a 20-foot wide emergency access drive. It's in a proposed 30-foot easement that would come off of where the existing entrance at WBBX Road is. It would cross through an existing railroad crossing easement and come up through the parcel via easement that would be deeded to the city for access. So that's an overall summary of the overall site plan. There was a number of comments, questions. They would receive a tax, so I tried my best to summarize those in the report. We had a number of them, so I will touch on those here and walk through the plan set. So on the site plans, there was a comment with respect to site lighting. I know that there had been some policy discussions in the last round of approvals with respect to lighting. I'm not sure where we stand with that, but what we have done is added the light at the intersection of Borthwick Avenue and the new road, same as we had previously done, and we have noted on there to coordinate the final lighting design with the Department of Public Works. Working our way down the road, there was some comments with respect to showing signage for the railroad crossing, so we've added some signage and markings as well. Rerouting the multi-use path across the railroad to a 90-degree angle to the greatest degree possible, so we've pulled the multi-use path off and angled it as such, so it hits 90 degrees to the best of our ability crossing those tracks. Also, what had been requested of us, and it's shown on the site plans and detailed further in the grading and drainage plans, is drainage easements. The road itself will be treated, stormwater from the road will be treated via treatment swales. Two of those swales are located on the applicant's parcel. So we've carved out the areas where those two stormwater, those swale areas are currently located and identified those as access easements for stormwater. On the flip side, the applicant does need to cross the road, discharge stormwater from their site. So we've also identified a drainage easement crossing the city right away that would be from the city of Portsmouth to the applicant. So that's a summary of the road design and some of the comments that we had received. Working to the site plan with the office building, again, 50,000 square foot office building, meets parking setbacks, site dimensional requirements. The building itself will have underground parking, two driveways accessed off of the proposed road, one off the cul-de-sac, and one further to the west. Again, on these plans, showing those drainage easements, and then also we identified the easement for emergency access, and I'll get into the plans a little bit more in the utilities plan, but as part of that, we updated the note to reflect that'll also be a water easement in there. The city had requested that we extend the water main from the proposed development out to Islington Street, and the applicant has agreed to do so, and that is represented on the utility plans. On that site plan, you'll see that we've identified some wetland buffer impacts and some restoration area that is part of our conditional use permit application. We look forward to meeting with the CONCOM to discuss that. But the net buffer impact, from the road that we can't avoid, we have to go through the buffer to removing the WBBX road from the buffer is a net permanent buffer impact of 500 square feet. There is some restoration notes on the landscape plan with respect to that restoration area. Grading and drainage, I mentioned the road itself will be treated by treatment swales. Three treatment swales, one on the west side of the tracks, and then two on the east side of the tracks. Those swales have been further detailed in this set. We did also receive comments, just general comments, to look at contours, grading, inverts, rims. So we've tried within that 2-day period to our best to clean this up. So hopefully that addresses a number of the comments that we had received. There was also a comment with respect to low spots at the railroad tracks. That's where the road converges at a low point. We've added some drainage to try to address that. We do acknowledge that that is going to require final coordination approval both by the Department of Public Works and Pan Am. That right now it's just we looked at trying to get the drainage back into the systems that we had designed in the road and the treatment swales, and we just can't do it. It's too shallow there for the pipe cover. So we have shown that we've made the effort, and we're willing to coordinate that further with the Department of Public Works and Pan Am to come to a resolution. I'm sure we can figure out a way to make the drainage work in those two areas. Moving across the railroad tracks into the site itself will be detained and treated by a gravel wetland system. The system itself actually will divert flows in both the north and south directions. That's to mimic the existing drainage patterns on the site. There's currently like a small ridge that kind of runs through the site, so some of the water sheet flows to the wetland in the north, some to the south. So we've designed the outlet structure to divert those flows. We had previously, I think I mentioned this at work session, originally had gravel wetland just going to the north, and a rain garden had been designed going to the south wetland. We've eliminated that gravel wetland, that rain garden, excuse me, at the request of the Conservation Commission. They had concerns with the amount of tree clearing that was involved, so we looked at alternatives to treat the stormwater, and what we've done is increase the gravel wetland size and modeled the outlet structure to divert those flows and mimic the existing drainage patterns. There was a comment with respect to the lower catch basin that enters into the gravel wetland area. We've revised the grading of the gravel wetland and the matching the top of that berm with the rim elevation so that drainage is not overflowing back into the parking lot. That gravel wetland is sized to detain a 100-year storm event, and in fact has a foot of freeboard and a 50-year storm event. And I should mention also, given the amount of disturbance that this project has, it will require an alteration of terrain permit application with the state. So that is in the works and will be submitted here in the next few weeks, a copy of which is provided to the City of Portsmouth. Working our way further to the east, looking at
Patrick, which plan are you referencing?
Sorry, I'm
right
just
now?
Yeah, I was just cruising.
Yeah, we're all in cruise mode right now.
Okay. Right here, sheet 103.2.
Okay.
The emergency access drive. There was a comment. We had it graded flat, so we've pitched it so that it would sheet flow across the drive. So I believe we addressed that comment. So that was some of the comments on the grading and drainage. There was a memorandum included in the original packets for stormwater, and as I stated, you will get the detailed alteration of terrain permit application as well. Moving to the utility plan, the one comment that we had received was the size of the sewer main. I think we had shown a 12-inch. We've reduced that to an 8-inch. We've pulled the gas service station for tapping into the high pressure line as far back off the road that we can, still staying within the reserved right-of-way. The sewer manhole structure that we're tying into, there was some comments with respect to grades and looking at the size of that given the drop, and we have I think fixed on the plan shown in the profile that matching the finish grade of the road for that structure, and also noted on the plan that prior to construction the structure's invert elevation and manhole diameter need to be verified. There was a comment that there will need to be sleeve designs for the railroad crossings. We acknowledge that. I anticipate we'll have to work through those designs, both with the Department of Public Works and Pan Am, and have added that note. Proposed utility crossing designs, including sleeves, shall be coordinated with DPW utility companies and Pan Am Railway. Moving to sheet 104.2. I mentioned that we have extended the water from the cul-de-sac to Islington Street, and those notes should match what was previously shown on the approval, the plans that you folks had recommended approval to the planning board last May. We relocated the hydrant at the request of the fire department. We did add the communication note to the utilities note. And also, speaking of notes, we did amend, I think it was existing conditions note number 6. It had referenced when the original wetland delineation had been prepared. I believe it was July 2013. That had been amended following our meetings with the Conservation Commission and peer review. Jim Gove had walked that site with Mark West, and they concurred on a final wetland delineation, so that note's been amended to reflect that. I think there was also a comment that we need to put hydrant at the high point of the road. Sorry, that's back at 104.1. So there is a hydrant on the new road on sheet 104.1. Moving to the landscape plan 105.1. We had removed that magical tree that was going to be planted in the middle of the railroad. That is no longer there. And the last was a comment that we had with respect to landscaping the interior of the cul-de-sac. I know there was some back and forth discussion as to what should be done or what could be done there and who would be responsible for maintaining it. I did discuss it with the applicant. He would be willing to landscape it if the city would like to maintain it, but I did not show anything at this time as the applicant does not wish to maintain landscaping that's within the city right-of-way. If the city's open to some sort of hardscape design, we could look at that as well. Certainly there's some options there, but the applicant doesn't want to be responsible for landscaping that's located in the middle of the city right-of-way. As I mentioned previously, on sheet 105.1, we did include, there's some buffer planting sequence notes with respect to the restoration area and also the temporary grading that we need to do within the buffer for the stormwater management. I think that summarizes the plan set and some of the comments that we tried to address to the best of our abilities. Jason Plourd is here. We had included in your package a traffic study as well. So Jason is here to just give you a brief overview on that, very brief, and then we will move on to comments and questions from you folks.
Good afternoon. Jason Plourd with Beta Group. Very brief. As you all have been involved with this subject site for a while now, we did not reproduce or go out there and redo all the data collection that was previously gathered in 2015. Based on coordination efforts with the city staff, what we did was we used the information that was collected in 2015 as a baseline and then built upon that with this proposed development. Ultimately, what we did was we went to an opening year condition and then an opening year plus 10 years condition, which is consistent with local and state guidelines. Then we added our site traffic on top of it, took a look at Borthwick Ave, the proposed site driveway, and three other intersections. We took a look at the Borthwick Ave intersection with one bypass. Then as you're going down towards Route 33, we have that signal as well with Borthwick and the unsignalized intersection right off of 33, which is Greenland Road and Borthwick Avenue. So we took a look at what the operations would be with and without the proposed development. The impacts are not significant because we're talking about a 50,000 square foot office development, not going to generate a whole lot of traffic, and plus we're not connecting down to Islington Street, other than for emergency access purposes only. So what we did was we stayed consistent with our previous recommendation when the other development project was in front of you for the subject site, which was to make the unsignalized intersection of Greenland Road, Borthwick Avenue, an all-way stop condition. As you may know, the Greenland Road approach is the only approach out of that three-legged intersection that is free flow control. So that doesn't have a yield sign, it doesn't have a stop sign. By placing a stop sign at that, on that approach, we're able to control the operations, provide more opportunity for other movements to take place, and improve safety as well. So that's a brief synopsis of the study.
That was good for a traffic engineer.
Not bad, huh?
Impressed.
And Eric knows I like to talk.
Okay, anything else from you guys?
I'm Rob Chindella, and all I wanted to underscore was what Patrick said, the relationship between the application before you today and the pending Supreme Court appeal. What we said to the city, as in our application materials, is that if this application is approved, the appeal to the Supreme Court will be withdrawn. And we've said to the city attorney's office we'd make it clear at every step of the proceeding that that's a representation we're making of record. And if there are any questions about that, I'm happy to take them.
Okay, thank you. Okay, questions from TAC.
Hey, Rob, while you're up. What is the nature of the reserved right-of-way across the first parcel off of Borthwick? The road is intended to be in an 85-foot strip there, and it says reserved right-of-way. Are you intending to give the city fee ownership of the land underneath that, or are they intending to give us a right-of-way across someone else's land?
Well, state law allows a highway to be laid out over easement or fee. I'm not sure that we have an answer for you today. I mean, it's certainly
the city's preference would be to own the property.
Understood. And so, because we have an access easement, we would need to work with a third party to deliver what you seek. But the law does not require the fee, but I understand your position and we'll address it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other questions? Eric, do you have anything?
Sure. A comment at first. The railroad crossing on the road with the bike path, that'll require its own set of signs as well. The crosswalk and whatever else gets put up in there.
You want to just give us a sheet reference so we can...
Oh, I'm looking at C-102.1.
Okay, thanks.
And any, whatever crossing comes up has to be approved by Pan Am as well. Crossing treatment. But you already have the notes on that.
Yep.
The other comments I have is on the traffic study. I'd like to have a peer review on that. Okay. And one concern I have, maybe the peer review could answer, is the need for a left turn lane on Borthwick at the side driveway. Okay. Other than that, there was one question. The traffic study in the plan sets referred to office building. I didn't know if it was medical office or just regular office.
That's a great question, Eric. I think we show it as office. It could be either. They're both allowed, and obviously, given the location, it's a strong possibility that it's medical office. So I think what we'll do is revise the plans to say office or medical office because the parking requirement is the same.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then Jason, I think you took a look at medical office.
A couple things, Eric, to address your questions. I took a look at the exclusive left turn lane warrant on Borthwick Ave. And under the 2018 build conditions, during the weekday morning and the weekday evening, it does not trigger it. Under the 2028 build PM, it does not trigger it. The time that it does trigger it is under 2028 build morning. So by going out to 2028, who knows if the actual projections are going to be accurate or not, and who knows if more development's going to occur in the area. So give that to you for your information. As far as the general office building for trip generation as compared to medical office building, during the morning, there would be an increase of 10 vehicle trips per hour if we went with the medical, so it's pretty negligible. During the PM, it was a total of 22 vehicle trips per hour, so 21 in, one exiting, you know, dispersed between going to one bypass versus 33. It's pretty negligible for trip generation comparison. It is slightly higher, but I don't anticipate that it would have any different results for intersection operations than what was presented in the traffic study.
Okay.
Julia? If I could, just a question on that. I'm not a traffic guy, so you have to educate. I understand those numbers on a regular office. People come to work, they stay, then they go home. Mm-hmm. However, medical office building, with the normal turnover, let's say the average person comes in for possibly an hour for an appointment,
mm-hmm.
There'll be considerable comings and goings throughout the entire day, as opposed to morning and evening.
Are you sure you're not a traffic engineer? Because that's
a good
question.
Work?
Yeah. So and the reason why I didn't get into it was because in the traffic engineering world, when we're talking about designing improvements, we look at the peak hours. But you're absolutely right. Over the course of the day, a medical office building is going to generate more traffic than a general office building, because you're right. In the morning, a general office building, people are coming in and they're parking for 8 hours. And then they're leaving all at the same time. And there's the fluctuation, the turnover with the medical or dental office building. One of the things that that we look at as traffic engineers is, you know, how long is a stay? For retail, it's going to be less than an hour. So one car going in can be coming out in that same hour, represents one vehicle, but two trips. For a medical office building, I haven't been in a medical office building for less than an hour, you know, whether it's, you know, for a doctor's appointment or a dentist's office visit. So again, that one vehicle is going to enter very similar to a general office and sit there, but it's going to leave at a different hour. So like, let's say that you go in at 4 o'clock, you're going to get out after 5, you know, in general sense. So that that exiting trip would not be counted in the same hour that the entering trip occurred. Over the course of the day, yes, it would be generating more of a turnover than a general office building. But during the hour, the peak hours in the morning and in the afternoon, it would generate very similar to a general office building.
Can I can just add, Carl, I think one thing you're looking at is the traffic throughout the day, but the traffic study looks at the overall worst case scenario. So it takes the peak hour, which is about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and then adds the traffic on from the building to that. Even though it would generate traffic throughout the rest of the day, the rest of the day, the traffic out on the street's not going to be anywhere near the level that it is at peak hour.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, right, go ahead, Eric.
Just another comment on offsite. The intersection of Route 33 and Borthwick, that signalized intersection with a left turn in the morning, that backs up, you know, back to the 95 ramps, and that's, it's a state controlled location, but I would like to see the applicant work with the state to fix that situation, to get rid of that queue that blocks the 95 off ramp. Whether or not that's just some signal timings or some new equipment, whatever, they should look into that with them.
Yeah, we have no problem reaching out to the state.
Okay. Other questions from or comments? Yeah, Dave.
Hey, Rob. This proposed 20-foot access road out to Islington Street. Is the applicant proposing that the public would be able to use that as a walking or biking trail besides, or is that, what is the applicant's position on that?
I think what we've talked about is that the public would be permitted to use it. It's subject, the primary, I guess I would look at the deputy chief. In some ways, the fundamental purpose of it is to provide emergency access. So any type of use, public or otherwise, which compromise that fundamental purpose would not happen. But otherwise, Yes.
Okay.
If I could, Madam Chair.
Yep.
Just to quickly go back to the extent that the city's going to seek a peer review on the traffic, given what I said before is kind of what we're in this context of this pending Supreme Court appeal for efficiency, and since Jason's work built on the work he did previously, we would expect that the city would use the same reviewer, the TEC, for the peer review. I think you're using them as a matter of course anyway, but it seems to me that would make the most sense in terms of moving this along. And we'd like to move it along as quickly as possible, obviously.
Okay. All right, Dave, you had other comments? Oh, sorry, I just want to go back. Do you have any comments about having it be a shared path?
No, so long as it's not, you know, it's, movement is not compromised, we have no problem.
Okay. And it seems wide enough that right. You could move to the side if you need to. Okay. Dave?
Okay. Patrick. I think that it would be appropriate to have lighting standards every 250 feet or so down the road.
Okay.
So if you could show that on the next plan iteration, it'd be great.
Dave, can we just check in on that one? So you said lighting?
Standards?
Right? Yeah.
Yes.
Do you, not to the fire road though, right? Just to the,
on the,
to the
road.
Main road?
Yes.
Not the fire access. Okay. Right. And follow up with that. You wouldn't expect the fire access to be lit, right?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Regarding the center of the cul-de-sac, I think we'd be willing to accept a hardscape in the center of the cul-de-sac to avoid having a completely paved surface out there.
Okay.
The pervious hardscape, Dave?
Yeah.
What? Pervious?
Pervious hardscape, I said.
Pervious?
Is that what you said?
In a roadbed?
In the center of the cul-de-sac.
In the center of the cul-de-sac.
No, we can look at it.
I want to add something to that later anyway.
Okay.
Okay. The rail crossing on the north side ends 200 feet up from the rail from the road crossing. I think one of the major comments with the rail crossing is we're going to want that rail crossing upgraded to provide a dependable crossing for the city since it's going to be in our right of way.
Mm-hmm.
So I want you to work with Boston and Maine and see if they can eliminate that northern trail since it doesn't go anywhere. And I'm sure the only reason it's still there is because they never took out the switch. But if the crossing is going to get replaced, then it's probably within the limits of the crossing anyway. And that would really simplify the rail crossing. So in the next month, I'd like to at least have to start discussions with them so we know which way it's going. Okay? Need to show a waterline easement. We're going to request a waterline easement that replaces any existing easements that we have for that 16-inch main going across the lot. What is the intention with the two existing houses that are out there? The demolition plan doesn't speak to whether they're being removed or not, or they're going to be used as residential uses. It doesn't say anything that I found.
Down here?
Yeah, that one and the other one, just to the north of it.
This one?
Up.
Up here?
That one.
These are gone.
They're already gone?
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll have to
so the water services for those have to be abandoned at the main?
Mm-hmm.
One of them has a very substantial water service that taps off that 16-inch line on the other side of the EBX road. The 12-inch water line that's coming off that you're showing attaching to the Islington Street, I have to get clarification, quite frankly, from Terry. That road's going to be completely repaved by the time you get there. So thinking right now showing the main extension going to the 16-inch.
Okay.
And you should show a valve probably 20 feet back from the 16-inch so that when we have to replace the 16-inch, the 12-inch main can be isolated so you don't lose water.
Okay.
I know you said you put the drainage easements on there, but I haven't looked at them yet, so.
We do need to add, I just quickly had sketched them onto the site plans. They need to get also added to the subdivision plans as well.
Couple more things, almost done. Patrick, over by Islington Street, you're showing removing the existing utility pole behind the house that was there. I think that's going to create a guy situation that you're going to need to guy that pole.
Okay.
Can't guy it because it's the property line's right there.
Okay.
So we might have to keep a pole there as a guy. So we need to look at that.
Okay.
The intention is to have that public access. You should probably note that on the plan. The only thing that's really still kind of out there that I really don't like is the drainage at the railroad tracks. So
yep.
I want to continue, maybe have a separate meeting with you about that so that we can figure out what to do. I'm thinking you might have to put a swale down to that wet area.
Okay.
So that you can actually drain that. I'm yep. very concerned about that.
Okay.
I was looking at your response to Ray's comments about the catch basin behind the building, mm-hmm. and how you lowered the berm in the gravel wetland to make sure that if the gravel wetland filled up, is that what you?
So we've made the gravel wetland bigger.
So I think what Ray was saying is because the catch basin's in a bowl.
Yeah.
The lowest rim of that bowl, so if the catch basin masked over by leaves or something, the lowest rim of that bowl was the building. So what Ray was saying, I think, is to lower the other end of the parking lot so that the water would bail off the parking lot before it went into the building if somehow the catch basin ever masked over.
Okay.
I think that's what he was talking about.
Is that what you were talking about, Ray?
yes, it was. Yeah, if the catch basin ponded around the catch basin, it would enter the building before we go over the berm into the gravel well.
Got it. We'll take a look at it.
Just looking at the spot grades, it looks like that.
Sheet C505 details. We won't be using the Legend LED. We'll be using the LED heads that we use on all the on the roadway lighting around town. So we will provide the 5 light heads for you. You need to provide the poles, the foundations, and the wiring, and we will provide you the light head for your installation. Okay?
Yep.
Need to add the details for the railroad crossing on the striping details. And I think that was it.
Okay. Ray, do you have anything to add to Dave's summary of your comments?
I just had a couple of additional questions. Some of them David mentioned too about that drainage area around the railroad crossing. That seems to be resolved. There was a curious note on G101.2.2, note 15 on the site notes about easements, and I wasn't sure what it was meant for. That access and drainage easements and maintenance agreements should be coordinated with the property owner and the city of Portsmouth prior to construction, which may need to be done prior to approval. I don't know. But also, the next sentence, easements and agreements shall be written such that they may be revised if the parcels are developed in the future. So I don't know what that refers to or what the meaning of that note was.
Sure, I will. It's the same note carried over from the prior project.
Right.
And it could be edited. It had to do with where we had some of the drainage. I think it's less so in this case because the swales where they are tucked into the road and in between the road and the wetland, they're not going to get developed in that location. Previously, we had some stormwater management where it may have been altered when we went in with future development. So I'll take a look at that note and can update it.
What number note was it?
Note 15 on the site notes.
Thank you.
On G101.2.
Yep. Eric, did you have anything else?
No.
Nope. You already had a chance. Carl.
Before Nick gets
that's
him.
That's right.
Pat, just one question. You did use our turning template on the cul-de-sac, correct?
That is correct.
And we can get around the cul-de-sac regardless of whatever hardscape is placed in the center?
You can, yes.
As long as it's
thank
mountable.
You. Yes.
Right. So,
it will be, I think... I should have brought it with me, and I apologize. I believe it was a 20-foot radius that we had.
As long as you put the truck template on that, and it works.
Yep.
Thank you.
We'll include it with the next package to show it.
Robert, you have anything? Who wants to go next, Peter or Nick?
I'll go.
Okay.
Detail for the swale, is that the erosion blanket detail? The erosion control blanket installation, or is there no detail for the swale?
Should be a detail for the swale. Written.
C502 is where the erosion control.
No, I mean, yeah, that is generally the swale detail, but we can add more to that, more detail.
Yeah, I'd
to
like
that.
To have some more detail in terms of plants or seeding, how you're going to seed it, but it's kind of
yep.
referred to there. But the key thing on that detail, the first. Number one, and it says to prepare soil before installing blankets, including application of lime, fertilizer, and seed. If it's in the 100-foot buffer, it shouldn't be putting fertilizer in there. If we can, you can do lime and seed. But
understood. We'll update the detail. Okay. It was just a typical that we had pulled down.
Yep. And then on the gravel wetland, I think we might want to do some kind of reporting or deed notice about the gravel wetland just to make sure it gets maintained in perpetuity, well, or at least runs with the site.
Okay.
What did he say?
And then the landscaping. So on the landscape plan, there's not, I don't know if you've not done with that yet. There's no specification on which plants are where. So that needs to meet our regs in terms of
yep.
Notifying which plants are where. And I think I had a comment about that too. Yeah, I think that was just it, that we need to know what you're planning where and how that's going to go. Sorry.
No, sorry.
And then on the building, there's no green building specification listed for that for our regs. We want to see that. And I want to revisit the idea, and maybe we'll make it a recommendation but to the planning board, but I think given the length of the cul-de-sac and the amount of disturbance in the undisturbed area, it makes sense to protect the 100-foot buffer that remains in perpetuity, and I'd still like to see that. I know you guys responded to that in your comments, that you thought that the 100-foot wetland buffer ordinance would protect it, but it'd be nice not to even have to go there with that again in the future, given the amount of development or amount of the size of the road and the size of the impact out there. But that'll be a recommendation probably to the planning board. So I think that's all I had
okay.
for now.
Nick?
Okay. Not a lot to add. First, I want to support Peter's last statement about protection of the buffer zone beyond just the wetland regulations themselves. Number two, I would have hoped we could have come to agreement on a narrower emergency access drive than 20 feet, but I guess that's what it has to be. So I'll jump to number three, which I'm probably going to lose to. Yep, I moved on for Carl for now. But I'm back to the cul-de-sac. I still don't understand why our position is we want to create something that's unnecessary, which is 2,000 square feet of pavement in the middle of it that no one ever has to drive over. It's, you know, 40 cars fit in the 8,000 square feet of pavement that's out there. I know you got to have it for the fire apparatus to make the turn, but I don't see why we couldn't have a landscaped island with almost no maintenance with a tree in the middle and ground cover. There's no grass cutting. You'd have to cut the ivy around the edge every once a year. There wouldn't be any work involved, and it would look a million times better for your client to have a building there that's probably going to be $10-15 million, and they're going to be staring at a tennis court sized cul-de-sac with nothing going on in it. So I'd like to think you guys could reconsider maintaining something that really requires no maintenance, and you're going to be cutting the grass in front of the building. There's going to be a landscaper that's going to get hired for that building. So I just think it's short-sighted, and I think it's unsightly and environmentally unfriendly, and it's not what Portsmouth should be promoting for space that has no functional benefit at all.
Okay, so I'll just end by saying I support that Nick's comments. I think, to me, I'm sorry, the maintenance thing, I think we can come to a solution on that one. I just don't think maintenance is going to be that hard. There's not a lot of traffic on this road. We'll figure something out. I didn't see anything about bike parking, considering you're going to be pretty close to the future rail trail. I think, you know, and maybe you were considering interior, but I did just some kind
I'll
of
specify it on the plan.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that was the extent of my notes.
We forgot to mention that we need independent inspection of when the road gets built. Sorry.
It's okay.
Yeah. Third party inspection by the developer.
Okay.
Agreement.
Yep. So third party inspection?
Yes.
Okay. I think that was it for me. Anything else?
There was one other comment about the elevations. I don't think these are the right elevations, or Nick and I were talking about it earlier.
Oh, yeah, the elevations. Thank you.
They don't match the site plan, yeah. The entryways.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, I'm opening the public hearing. Come on up.
Love these short tack meetings, don't you?
Yep, very much so.
Good afternoon. Paul Mantle, 1490 Islington Street. Interesting. Now, from what I understand, it's very hard to hear up in the bleachers. This is still very preliminary. They still need conditional use permit for wetlands buffer and variances, waivers from the planning board, correct?
No variances. Right?
No variances.
No
just
variances.
Site plan approval and subdivision
waivers,
approval.
Maybe.
Okay. Big waivers difference. From the planning board.
Yep.
Okay. As opposed to a variance for the BOA.
Correct.
It would all be part of the same approval, though.
Correct. Yep. And a conditional use permit for wetlands. Correct. Okay. From my perspective, I mean, obviously the emergency access road is concerning. I agree with Nick. I don't see the need for the cul-de-sac. It seems a lot of pavement for an office building. But the emergency access road is still concerning, mainly because since what has gone on before, I'm concerned that somewhere down the line, that emergency access road is going to be turned into a through street. Now, from my understanding of it's going to be gated, two gates. And from what I understand on how emergency access roads work, if they're gated, is the emergency vehicle comes to the gate, opens it up, goes through the gate, shuts the gate, then goes to the next gate. It's not open both gates, scream through it. They have to stop. I don't see where it's needed. I think the fire department would rather have unfettered access to a property and a building rather than, lack of a better term, fettered. An emergency vehicle, an ambulance, coming from Islington Street would have to go through a gate, stop, open it, stop again, close it, go through another gate, stop, open it, stop, close it, to get to the site, and then stop again at a graded rail crossing before they went anyplace. It would make more sense if the bridge was back. then they would eliminate the need for any emergency access road from Islington Street. Point one. Number two is, as I said before, the concern of the neighborhood is any sort of public access from Islington Street, the emergency access road, and we can see the need for that, although I don't see it at this point in time. But you want to do, you know, walking, walkers, bikes to the rail trail, fine. That portion of WBX Road, which is public right now, fine. Beyond that, either should remain private or a deed restriction put in place so that it never becomes a public access road. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul, and I appreciate your keeping it brief for us. That was nice of you. okay, so anybody else speak to, for, or against? Go ahead.
I'm Carl Cressy with Liberty Mutual Insurance, 225 Borthwick Ave. We submitted a written statement, hopefully you folks have in front of you. In the interest of time, I'll summarize rather than read verbatim. Mm-hmm. So our concern is traffic, and it's good to hear that traffic study was done, and if I understood correctly, a peer review of that will be done mm-hmm. as well. Okay, good. So our site is bisected by Borthwick Ave. So all of our parking is on one side, the building's on the other. So everyone that comes to the site has to cross Borthwick Ave twice, coming and going. So we've got something on the order of 2,000 person crossings a day. With the increased development on Borthwick Ave over the years, traffic's increased, speed has increased, we've got distracted drivers going on, we have a lot of near misses with our folks crossing the road there. So our concern really is with safety, and we're interested to know what potential mitigation steps could be taken to make sure that the increased traffic resulting from this development doesn't decrease the safety.
Okay, thank you. I just realized that I did not actually distribute your letter, but they all have it now, so.
I did want to state in general, we don't have an objection to the development. So we're just concerned about the safety of our visitors and employees.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll close the public hearing. All right. I think we have some things to resolve.
Yes.
Okay.
But at the same time, I think we've given the applicant pretty clear direction.
Yeah, I agree.
So.
So I think by the next meeting, we should be able to see some clear, looking ready good. To move this on.
Yes.
Okay. All right, so I will entertain a motion.
So I'll move to postpone it to next month.
Okay.
For the applicant to finish the plans and work on the issues that were brought up.
Yep.
Second.
All those, any discussion? Okay. Yeah. I think we'll just, we talked about some things. We'll get working on the peer review for the traffic, which may or may not have to be completely done, but we'll talk about that. So obviously there are things we need to follow up with you or you need to follow up with us on. We understand that. Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Okay, last one. Thank you for hanging in.
One more. Still here?
I just want to say for the record, this isn't the latest TAC meeting that I've attended.
No, it's not. Yeah,
way to go, Julia. I can't believe you're doing this to us.
Thanks a lot, Julia.
I really
it's
can't.
All your fault.
Okay. Item N, the application of 215 Commerce Way LLC and Murray LLC owners for property located at 215 and 235 Commerce Way, requesting amended site plan approval to construct a 66,000 square foot three-story office building with a footprint of 22,000 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site.
No.
You know what? I just realized. Should we have voted on the subdivision too? We probably should have.
Oh, it was two things.
Yeah.
That's right.
Okay. Together. So, rewind. Okay. Okay. Sorry, I'm thinking while I'm talking. Okay. We'll say we approve both. Okay.
Related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 213 as Lot 11, and Assessor Map 216 as Lot 1-8A and 1-8B, and lies within the Office Research District.
Thank you. Patrick Remmons with Ty and Bond. Also here with me on behalf of the applicant is Rob Chandella. This is a project that was previously granted amended site plan approval back in May of 2016. In fact, this site's been before this board in a number of different manners since mid to late 2000s. But we're back before you folks seeking amended site plan approval. The prior approval had a three-phase approach. Phase one included upgrades to the existing office building, 215 Commerce Way. Phase two included the construction of a new 60,000 square foot office building with associated site improvements. And then phase three had included a four-story expansion and a parking deck. So we're back before you folks with amended plan that is just going to include two phases now. Phase one being the same previously approved phase one, which is the improvements to the existing office building at 215 Commerce Way. It's shown here on the site plan. And phase two, which is the construction of a 66,600 square foot office building with associated site improvements. This will include surface parking. And we'd be eliminating the phase three expansion. We would not be constructing an expansion onto this building nor a parking deck. This building would be a 66,000 square foot three-story building, so the footprint is a little larger than phase two, but is less than the overall phase two and three buildings from the prior approvals. I had included an overlay plan in your package, which I hope are helpful, which demonstrate that the site itself, if you're looking down from a mile-high view, is going to look pretty much the same in terms of impervious area, driveway locations, general building location from the prior approvals. The drainage design has not changed. It's the same with gravel wetland in the rear of the site. The utility plan has changed slightly, and that's only because the Commerce Way roadway has since been constructed, upgraded. Stubs were built into the site for drainage, water, and sewer. So rather than trenching into the road, as we had shown in the prior plan set, we'd just be connecting into those stubs to avoid trenching into Commerce Way. And we'd be proposing to bring the gas service out to Portsmouth Boulevard, where we're proposing to repave. I should mention that we're not seeking any different stipulations of approval from the prior approval. We're committed to the prior stipulations that we had committed to previously. I know there had been one comment raised at the work session with respect to tying the water service into 215 Commerce Way. The applicant would prefer to keep the stipulation that we had worked out with DPW and the legal department, and was a stipulation approval from the planning board that water service would be constructed when or if there was a transfer of land. Right now, because the owner owns both of those buildings, he's not wishing to do that water service because of the costs, primarily the interior upgrades. I know that we have stubbed in the site, Dave, you mentioned that, but just to avoid that unneeded cost at this time. So we're hopeful to that would remain a stipulation of approval as well.
Everybody, or if any of us have, any of you have the actual language by that, what Patrick's talking about, but if you want, I could just read it. It's pretty short, but it's really three conditions of our approval of May of 2016, 2, 3, and 4. 2, in lieu of requiring separate water service to the property at 215 Commerce Way, the property owner of 195 Commerce Way shall be responsible for payment of water and sewer fees for both 195 and 215 Commerce Way until such time transfer to either property, title to either property is transferred. 3, a recorded deed restriction shall be placed on both 195 and 215 Commerce Way, requiring that a separate water service from the water main in Commerce Way directly to the building at 215 Commerce Way shall be installed upon title transfer of either 195 or 215 Commerce Way. And then the fourth numbered stipulation, as consideration for foregoing immediate installation of a water service to 215 Commerce Way, the property owner shall pay the sum of $18,653.14, which covers the cost incurred by the city to provide water service. Those were the stipulations that Patrick is talking about that reflected our agreement last year.
Okay, so questions?
What were the original what were the original stipulations for this project? It's been so long, I've kind of forgotten about it.
Contributing $42,000 to the city for reconstruction of the sidewalk and $6,900 towards traffic and pedestrian signal upgrades at Market Street and Portsmouth Boulevard. And then I think Rob just read the other ones, a construction management plan, and then subsequent, the applicant would videotape the construction routes to the project prior to the initiation of site work and shall be responsible for repairing any damages during construction.
Okay, so the only issue I have with that is that those traffic signals are about to be upgraded. And probably 2 weeks we'll be going out to bid for that work. So it may be that you're reimbursing the city, and then that money will have already been spent, so it'll go back into our traffic fund. Acceptable? Because I don't think you're going to get your project underway in before the next 2 weeks, so we couldn't wait any longer.
Let's see.
Trying everything to get out of here.
You need to stand up with your
So it's just the improvements have been made, so we're just
continuing. Not yet, but they will be.
Yeah.
They'll be done by the fall.
So it's substantively the same.
It's fine. It just says for that signal, and
yeah.
I don't want the money to be held for that signal because it'll be another 20 years before we ready for something else for that signal, and it just seems kind of silly. So
yeah, my memory of that is that even when we were doing this last time, that was the idea was we were contributing to an overall improvement that was going to be executed at some other time. So I think that's consistent. But
okay.
In any event,
I just don't
acceptable.
Want it to be held for that signal alone forever.
We can word it that way.
Okay.
Got it. Yeah.
And then I think that would be appropriate because there's one water service going to two buildings. I think it'd be appropriate for the plumbing inspector to do an inspection of those buildings and make sure that those buildings are code compliant relating to the water services.
Okay, any other comment? I just want to note that when we are ready to make our recommendations, I had the correspondence from Rick Tainer relating to the agreement related to the extending the subdivision approval that you came up with the legal department, right? So we'll make that a condition of approval, I believe.
You want to reference that's also a tripartite agreement.
Yep.
That's recorded at the registry. We sent it to the city attorney, but yep. Certainly.
So we'll just reference. Okay. Any other comments? All right, I am going to open the public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, against? Nobody rises. Closing the public hearing. Whew. Okay, I will entertain a motion.
Move to recommend this on to the planning board with the two stipulations that I already mentioned.
Okay, and then just the stipulation that the subdivision plan and deed from PSNH be recorded prior to the issuance of a building permit.
Second.
Right. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Well done, everyone. Motion to adjourn. Okay.
Second.